Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 merrily. Life is but a holographic co-creative dream. Aloha, students, once again, and welcome to another exciting, consciousness-shifting, inspirational, and educational episode of Paradigm Shift Dream Class. My name is Brendon, and thank you so much for being here. And of course, we are joined with some other amazing shifters tuning in, broadcasting all across the globe. Fellow shifters here with me tonight, let's unmute our microphones and say hello to the beautiful people tuning into this. So, hello, hello, beautiful people.
Hello,
what's up, beautiful people.
Hello,
beautiful people.
Hello from Earth.
Yes.
In other dimensions.
Hello from C. What was it? Remind me again.
C137.
C137. That's right. Shout out. Rick and Morty reference. That's right. We got it going on. So.
Hello from Yavin.
Yavin Ford. Cool. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much, guys, for tuning in. Again, this is always an exciting opportunity that we have here as a class. And just as a quick introduction for those of you who may be tuning in for the first time, Paradigm Shift Dream Class is an extension of the bigger project at ParadigmShiftCentral.com, which is what we refer to a real-world game to help shift consciousness. And, of course, you can check out a lot of awesome stuff at the main website. It's a portal and a platform for conscious media and for community, and it's like its own social network, and it's an entire community of people who are actively exploring metaphysical topics and intentionally helping assist with the shift in consciousness through the expansion of their own mind. And there's also the idea of the paradigm shift communities that exist all across the world. And just as a quick shout out and a heads up, on the next broadcast coming up this Thursday is going to be the Paradigm Shift admin meeting. And if you're interested in learning more about how to create physical paradigm shift communities and to be a leader in your community, then be sure to tune in for that one as well. Whereas for here, what we're going to be doing tonight, we're going to just be opening up this conversation. We're going to be creating a sacred space for us to talk about the ever popular topic of lucid dreaming, dream exploration, astral projection, understanding this multidimensional reality, infinity, and beyond. So when it comes to the basics within dreams, let's just, I'll take a moment here just to sort of list a couple things off the top of my head in terms of recent things that we've covered in previous broadcasts. And definitely, if you are new to this, if this is maybe your first time tuning into Dream Class, I highly encourage you to check out the previous Dream Classes that we have online through the main website. You can find those in the podcast feed. And this is a fourth Dream Class, so there's at least three other ones that you can check out. But some of the things that come up time and time again, and some of the things that I just like to reiterate, is that the topic of dream exploration is really interesting and really relevant because it helps people understand more about their multidimensional nature. It's this basic idea that we are more than the physical body, and this is something that can be experienced by oneself, for oneself. So every night when we go to sleep, it's this idea that we're experiencing reality from beyond our physical body, from within the astral body, and we're literally traveling into the astral realms. And again, you know, what are the astral realms? The astral realms, from my understanding and my perspective, they're kind of this idea of like a place closer to where we're actually from, meaning it's very reminiscent of where we are before we are born and after we die. And the interesting thing is we go there every night when we sleep, and this is where you get ideas of being able to communicate with loved ones. And what can you do in dreams? Again, you know, you can experience these places, you can experience communication with intelligent entities, and also be able to learn a lot about yourself and to be able to see the lessons and the experiences that the universe is helping pass on to you to help accelerate your personal evolution as a soul, as a cosmic citizen. So the emphasis and the reiteration as to why we do this class is to, again, encourage people to talk about this subject and ultimately to bring it into a form of practice for themselves and to work towards things like lucidity within the dreams and within the waking state, the idea of just waking up our consciousness to the bigger picture as a whole. So we'll definitely talk more about lucid dreaming, and again, this is a chance for us to talk about how dreams have been going for us, some progress reports from us, and also a chance for us to share some questions together as a team. So let's just do a quick introduction, and we'll go around the circle before we get into the conversation related to questions. But for the people who are here, we have Kiwi, who's a good buddy from London, Ontario, Canada, with Paradigm Shift London that I'm also a part of, and we have John, or Ron as he may choose to go by, and we have Caitlin and Sky running off one laptop feed, and we also have Nikki tuning in from the UK area. So shout out to you guys, and thank you so much for being here. So we'll let's let's go around the circle, and maybe from left to right, Kiwi can start first, but let's take the turns answering the question of why we are here. Like, literally, like, why did you choose to come to this class, and maybe what do you hope to get out of it? So, Kiwi, go ahead.
Well, I guess short train of thought, or cause and effect, is a dream led me here. I had a dream about a paradigm shift meeting. That was awesome. I followed that dream, went to the meeting, didn't happen to be there. Then I looked at your paradigm shift page on Facebook, and then I saw your, and I'm still looking through it. I watch about a half hour, 45 minutes a day, about the one with the lady and the very animated guy. I wish I knew the names. And you were saying some stuff in there that was really brilliant, especially about the dreams, and really resonated. So I said, you know what? I got to check out this dream class. And I'm here. So a dream led me here.
That's, yeah, I mean, that in itself, I think, is really cool. The idea that, like, you had a dream. It sort of brought an idea into your waking life. You followed through with that in action, and then one thing led to another, and that inspired you to be here. And that in itself is something we can talk about, the idea of, like, how events within our dreams actually, like, have a cause and effect within our waking state, and how the two, like, the waking state affects the dream state, and the dream state affects the waking state. So, yeah, that's a very interesting premise that we can get into more. So, cool. Kiwi, thanks again for being here, man. It's good to connect with you again. And so we'll pass it over. And Ron, do you wanna go ahead and just introduce yourself? And again, what brings you to dream class?
Hi, I am Ron. On the Paradigm Shift website, I go by the name Ron's Art. On my Google account, it's John, so whatever you feel like calling me, just call me that. for sake of argument, call me Ron's Art. That's my Paradigm Shift name. But anyway, what brought me to Paradigm Shift was actually I've been practicing shamanism for a couple years now, both with drumming and with the use of entheogens, such as ayahuasca, salvia, and the list goes on. Terrence McKenna has a great list of stuff, all natural plant medicine, I should really say, and I've noticed that, I should probably say this. I was searching through YouTube, and I was just looking up, you know, just salvia videos, and I was seeing just idiot after idiot after idiot just posting their salvia experience, and just like, I'm like, you know, yelling at my screen, no, you're doing it all wrong. You're not showing respect to the medicine or to your ancestors or to Mother Earth or spirits or anything, nothing. They're using shamanic tools with no shamanism, and they're having horrifying experiences. And then I come to your video, and I see, okay, here's these guys. They're doing it right. They're, you know, paying their respect to the medicine, to Mother Earth, to salvia, and you had a wonderful experience. And I was like, okay, this guy's, he's got something, he's on the right track here, you know. And then I saw that you know, you're connected with the Paradigm Shift website, and then I looked up Paradigm Shift website, and I was like, oh, okay, I see where they're going here. They're all about dreams. And I noticed that dreams, with lucid dreaming, you'll actually find that a lot of times after an ayahuasca experience, a lucid dream will happen that night. In fact, that was one of my most memorable lucid dreams. And one thing I noticed was there wasn't much difference of a feeling. In both times, it feels like you're leaving your body, at least with me. I can only speak from my own experience. Like, I feel like a radiated, glowing, warm body just raising from my, you know, this shell of an earth body. And so I'm interested in finding the connections between shamanic practice and lucid dreaming, and see if we could find some sort of path that, you know, will make each other stronger.
Yeah, that's the topics between shamanic medicines and the psychedelic realms and dream exploration is definitely something I am also very interested in. I feel like there's a just trying to think of what I could say about that now to keep it short and sweet. But yeah, like I think what within the psychedelic medicines, it's definitely like this blatant exploration of inner space and this idea of like there's more to this reality than meets the eye. And definitely psychedelics will show you like whatever you're thinking will come to the surface. It's like a magnifying glass for your psyche is one of the best ways I can say it. And I feel that dreams literally do that exact same process. And then kind of what you alluded to, John, like the idea of what happens when we actually do psychedelics within our dream state. And then like people actually have reported this, you know, they'll talk about it. They'll be like, yeah, like I smoked DMT in my dream and I had like a visceral experience, or I did mushrooms in my dream and it was like I was on mushrooms. So that's actually like more than a common thing. And that's something we could definitely talk more about. And again, you know, for people listening, John was specifically referencing in terms of the Salvia video. There's a Salvia video that I actually have on my channel. It may be on Lucid. I might have to double check it. Maybe it's not, but yeah, it was like my experience with the salvia, with working with salvia, and again, salvia is legal, so it was like easy to do a video for it. And within the I'll just say this so people can go check it out, and again, you can find it on my YouTube channel at Skull Babylon. But within the ceremony, like I actually had like a third eye activation where I was actually able to see things with my eyes closed. Like I had my eyes closed, but I could still like have my hands in front of me and still see, and it was just like amazing in that moment. And there's more to talk about there, so we'll do that. We'll explore some of the connections between dream space, between Aboriginal knowledge, between psychedelics, and how all of these things are, you know, again, like sort of perspectives looking inwards towards the same source kind of thing. So yeah, so John, thanks, or Ron, I'll say, Guardian of the Forest, thanks for being here, man. It's good to connect with you again, brother. So John, was there anything else that you want to add in on that? If you just want to, just as we keep moving along, feel free, or we can pass the talking stick along. I'll let you decide.
I mean, I could talk about this forever. Yeah. It's one of my favorite, you know, topics. But yeah, I'll just say, you know, thanks for having me on tonight, and let's hear what the next guy's got to introduction.
Cool. Awesome. All right. So we'll pass it over to we have Caitlin and Sky coming in through the same headquarters. So Caitlin, Sky, you guys can introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about what brings you to Dream Class.
Okay. I'm Sky. That's Caitlin. Caitlin was sending me emails and telling me all about what you do and the program you're with and all that, and it sounded really interesting. And she asked me if I wanted to stay the night and partake in this, because it's something that we both explore and think about and we've talked about individually together. And I guess it's just kind of interesting. It's new to be a part of an experience that is collective, you know what I mean? Like, everybody is sharing these experiences, and you come to find out that a lot of the things that you've been experiencing isn't actually that abnormal, you know? And a lot of the stuff you know is actually more widespread knowledge than it is credited for. And basically, I'm just here on interest in what all of you have to say, because it's something that I spend time thinking about, and she recommended that I join, and it was interesting.
I wanted to be here. I actually tuned into the health and fitness broadcast sometime last week, and I just find it really interesting to hear everyone else's opinion, and I know I really, really wanted to join in, but I didn't because the microphone doesn't work, but anyways, and I just find it interesting, and just everything is so intriguing to think about and to discuss, and I just love hearing new opinions and just kind of being able to open up, and that's kind of why I'm here, just because I found the whole project very interesting, and I want to be a part of it.
Cool. Well, yes, thank you so much, guys, and that's exciting. It's probably happened before, but I haven't yet to confirm it, but the idea of, like, people, like, organizing sleepovers around Paradigm Shift broadcasts. I think that's really cool. And especially one related to the Dream class, right? Because, like, you guys could... That's actually something really interesting, the idea of any time if we're, like, sleeping with someone else, and, you know, and then you get into the idea of, like, shared dreams, potentially, just by being in the same space, and just by being open to that intention. So, I mean, who knows, you know, like, if you guys are both sort of, like, approaching the topic of dream exploration together while sleeping in the same space, maybe you could, like, set an alarm later in the night and then both kind of wake up, check in with each other, even just, like, do, like, a short meditation and then go back to sleep or something, you know, and then, like, repeat this maybe, like, a couple times through the night. You guys will, like, literally be able to be, like, you know, like, journeyers, like, coming out of the dream then going back into it, and both of you together might be able to, like, help, like, trigger something within your, like, shared experience. So who knows, but yeah, if that's something that interests you, yeah, I'd love to hear more about how stuff like that goes, because there's a million and one ways to practice dream exploration, so that's cool. Yeah, so thanks again, guys, for being here. If you want to unmute yourself, if there's anything else you want to say before we pass the talking stick, feel free.
Thank you for sparking that idea, because it is... Suddenly, the concept of mutual astral projection is really possible sounding, if that makes sense.
And
definitely. Cool. All right. Well, we'll definitely we'll get back to that. We'll explore more about that topic, like shared projection, astral projection, or just lucid dreaming, shared dreams, and the idea of, like, how physical space affects your dreams in general. So cool. So thanks again, guys, for tuning in. And with that said, we'll pass the talking stick around, and we'll pass it over to Nikki. And Nikki was involved with the previous broadcast that we have had. And so, Nikki, welcome back, and please feel free to introduce yourself and what brings you to Dream Class.
Yeah, hi, this is Nikki, and I am on the Paradigm Shift website, and I go by the name Infinite Possibilities 33. Yeah, what brings me here? I've been here before on the broadcast, I think 2 weeks ago or something, quite spontaneously. I just, like, woke up in the night and I was checking my phone and I discovered that, you know, you had posted something. Yeah, but other than that, like, you know, I've been having all these cool, awesome, amazing experiences, but in quiet. Like, I don't know about over there in Canada or US, maybe it's like, you know, all this stuff, like, even about spirituality and, like, you know, dream exploration, maybe it's a bit more okay to talk about it over there. I don't know, but, like, here in the UK or in Europe, I mean, at least, like, 2 or 3 years ago even, it wasn't that okay to talk about these things. So anyhow, I've been having these amazing experiences in quiet, but it was almost like I was in the closet, but now I think it's time to come out of the spiritual closet and come out and play with others. You know, there's so much to do. And of course, like, you know, because I've been doing this since a few years, like, yeah, since I started waking up in 2009, actually, quite a dramatic awakening. It was also really cool. Yeah, all this in quiet, and I've been studying a lot and following a lot of cool people like Brendon on YouTube. And yeah, but now I think that it's time to come out and play with others, because, like, I mean, there's, like, it's really, really... I think it's like a phase or something, like when you do it, like, with your own self, like when you go within. But it's also really cool to come out and play with the others, like, you know. So yeah, that's why I'm here. I'm here to connect with the others.
Awesome. I like what you're saying there, just the emphasis on, like, now. You're right, because this is a topic that so many people have been exploring on their own for years, and without that community, it seems that the exploration can only go so far, and just by, like, engaging in conversations, it seems to spark something. It seems to spark new experiences, potentially, which is, like, a topic related to dreaming that I find really fascinating. The idea that when you literally put out that intention to the universe and say, like, dear universe, I am interested in studying my dreams, and the universe will be like, they are ready. Like, give them experience, and they, like, pass it on to you. But, like, until you openly ask for it, or you openly, like, pronounce it or enunciate it, it's sort of, like, holding back sort of thing. And one of the ways is, by being involved with the community and engaging with these discussions, even if it doesn't seem, like, that's what I mean. There's almost, like, a behind-the-scenes element where just by being here is actually, like, attracting, you know, call it law of attraction, is actually attracting more of these lucid and conscious experiences into your life, both within the dream state and in the waking state as well. So Nikki, it's awesome to have you here again, and thank you so much for staying up in the wee hours while in the UK.
Yeah, but I might drop off because, like, last time I got so tired, so I might.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm gonna stick around for at least in half an hour. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. Well, thank you so much, Nikki, for being here. And just a reminder for those of you who are tuned in live, and for those of you who are tuned into the future, always reminding you that this is a space that you guys can join at any time. And the links to do so I've posted on the ParadigmShiftCentral.com website and within the Facebook pages and all over the place. So feel free to join. And again, this class is every other Tuesday, and you can find the schedule for more ongoing events through the main website as well. So with that said, let's sort of begin exploring some questions together. And I know we were sort of talking about some questions before we even began the broadcast. I'm going to let you guys sort of like direct this class as well alongside me. So maybe Caitlin and Sky, I know you guys had some questions we were talking about earlier. Is there one that you feel would be a good one to start the class with, or just pick anyone and it'll be good enough, I'm sure. But I'll do you guys, yeah, okay. So go ahead, guys. I'll pass over to you if you guys want to jump in on that.
Well, one question that I especially wanted to talk about with more people was, like, the way that we tend to react upon situations in our dreams can be so enlightening about who you really are. Because I really, really strongly feel that when we react to a situation in our dreams, we are reacting out of pure just intuition, if you will.
And like our subconscious is controlling our reactions rather than like our conscious thoughts, so we don't have all these experiences built up to funnel the situation through before we react to it.
Yeah, like we're not trying to react upon an ego level or upon a logical level or a brain level, where we're literally reacting upon what we self level. And I have personally learned so much about myself in observing the way that I behave with others in my dreams. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, that's a really great topic. Like, just, you're right, like the idea of being able to observe like how we act within dreams. It's interesting because, you know, when we talk about dreams, we'll often talk about how a lot of people they pursue the idea of having lucidity. And again, you know, lucidity is when you know that you're dreaming within a dream. And when that happens, usually it's a very potent shift. You suddenly become aware. You're suddenly your like sensations shift. You feel that there's like a shift in the presence, and obviously it sort of like enables you to step into new abilities and all this exciting things. But nonetheless, though, like when we're in those dreams and we're kind of watching it almost as if it's a movie, those are equally important. And I think in some cases, like we kind of, there's almost like a guardian or a threshold that's sort of directing our dreams. And sometimes it's just not in the cards for us to be lucid. We're almost meant to sort of ride the dream like a roller coaster or watch it like a movie. But when we do that, you're right, like we see the way how we react within dreams. And that in itself like really brings the emphasis as to notes worth writing down when we are practicing recalling your dreams. You know, like, see what you did and write down how you responded, and then more so than anything, check in with how it made you feel. One of the things that I've said before within dream class is that dreams are very interesting because within dreams they will show both the hero and the villain inside all of us. And so, like, there's a lot of different scenarios that can come up in dreams, and it may be something where you just like perform a really admirable feat, and you're just like, oh my god, like, I've never, you know, maybe in a dream there's like some sort of like spiked pit of lava that you have to jump across in order to save a friend, and then in your dream you might be like scared as hell because you're convinced it's real, it's a real experience, and yet you still do it. And then you wake up from that dream and you're just like, holy crap, you know, like, I'm an action hero. Like, I'm someone who actually made that choice. And especially, you know, given that scenario, if it was like a choice that was governed by the heart and it was like for a friend and you did that, that would be like a really empowering thing. And maybe that would say to you when you wake up, it would be like, wow, you know, like, that reassures me and reminds me of my relationship with my friends, and I really care about my friends. You know, I'm gonna go out of my way for them, and I'm gonna help them. You know, this is sort of an example, but something like that could trigger ideas as to how you feel about yourself, how you see parts of yourself. And then in the same way, you know, this is another example, and I'll just say this and I'll open up a talking stick for anybody else to jump in, but oftentimes within dreams we'll see parts of ourselves that we don't even particularly want to acknowledge, but that's often why we see them, right? So it's us being able to acknowledge that there are maybe latent emotions still inside of us that we haven't dealt with, or just like other aspects to our ego that we're still dissolving. And it could be something where, say in a dream, you know, you might like get in a fight with a friend, or you might steal something, or, I mean, some people, you know, in dreams they have crazy things where they're like, yeah, like, not even like fight someone, but like actually like hurt someone or something, right? Like something really primitive or something, and then they sort of wake up from that and they're just like, it's like, oh my god, you know, like, what does that mean? And that in itself can be a very subjective thing, but it ultimately, like, you know, I encourage you to meditate on that. But at the very least, this is an example I've given before, if you like wake up from a dream where you've like hurt a friend, maybe that can give you the motivation to check in with yourself and to see maybe in the past if that friend did something to you that you felt like, you know, angered you or something. Maybe that's reminding you that it's time for you to forgive, because until you forgive, you're still holding on to this anger. And so, like, the dream is like reminding you, and be like, it's, again, you know, I've said this earlier, but the dreams are a magnifying glass into our psyche, and they're just showing us the stuff that we don't even want to see, but ultimately we need to see in order to, and I'll just say this as the last part, in order to ultimately, I feel, learn how to let go. Learn how to let go over and over and over again. That seems to be a common lesson. So dreams will be like, oh, by the way, you're still holding on to this. Oh, by the way, you're still holding on to grief from a past relationship. You're still holding on to, like, you know, like an old romantic relationship. That's something that comes up within dreams. Or you're still like, you know, like, you still have this connection, or you're, yeah. So I just feel that dreams are a great way to remind us of the importance of learning how to let go. But yeah, what do you guys think? Anybody feel free to jump in related to, again, you know, like, what we do within dreams help teach us. Because, again, it's all holographic. It's all a reflection. It's all there. It's all us. So what do you guys think? Caitlin and Sky, if you guys want to jump in, or Nikki or anybody, feel free. So
I feel that the dream lessons are a way of our guides, our ancestors, telling us or warning us in a way of, you know, something in the future. Like, it could be a dream of premonition, you know. It could be, you know, someone dreamed of a disaster a week before it actually happened. Or it could be something as small as, you're acting like a jerk in this dream, so when this actually does happen, be mindful of your attitude. Be mindful of your facial expressions and so on.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, that, you know, that gives into the topic of dreams and foresight. And yeah, dreams are simulations for events that have yet to occur in some cases. So that's good if we can go through an event, see what happens, and then learn from it. Sky, go ahead.
When you said that dreams can be a medium of, you know, higher beings or such interacting with us and kind of giving us, as you said, a premonition of future events, or kind of like a look through a telescope, I don't know if that is always necessarily the case. I mean, every dream is probably different and affected by different elements and whatnot, but I feel, as speaking personally, that
a lot of dreams are more of a reflection of our already unconscious understanding that exists within us. And I feel like there is not really a way to communicate with higher beings unless you were to find a way to gain control in the dream and silence your mind, so that way your mind stops projecting things onto the plane and you can just experience what is already there, and hence the higher beings. But dreams, active dreams, I feel as if are more a reflection of, you know, what is already taking place inside, what we may not have consciously discovered about ourselves, but exists within ourselves regardless.
Yeah, that's you're right. Like what you're talking about, the higher beings aspect. It would seem only in rare circumstances would something obviously as like a communication with a higher entity appear to you. Oftentimes, it is something where like yeah, you have to be lucid in order to like get past the illusion sort of thing. So there's a whole topic there that I actually want to get into, the idea of like. Are dream characters that we see within dreams, are they always projections of us, or are they sometimes like external intelligence that are logging into the shared dream space to interact with us? How do we differentiate the two? And again, you know, like if we become lucid, how can we bring in that conversation? This is still something, again, you know, like I'm openly exploring these topics together as well. But yeah, like just the idea that one person, when I was like studying dreams to begin with, it you can almost visualize this, you know, like when you're in a dream, it's almost like you're like wearing like a virtual reality helmet or like a 360 dome that's just like a bubble that goes around your head, and you're kind of like in, you know, almost like a holodeck sort of thing. So like everything that you see literally is you, like it, at least at its core level, it is you. And then when you understand that, it's just like an important. It's important to keep that in mind when you're studying your dreams, you know, when you see other characters, like, are they actually your friend, or is it, like, your projection of your friend, which is relating back to you for a specific reason? It's just something that people have to, like, really sort of, like, explore for themselves, feel it out and everything. But, yeah, getting into, like, the concept of, like, communicating with higher entities within the dream, we can get into that a little bit later, because there's actually, like, a new idea that recently came to me within the last couple of weeks that I did want to share with you guys. But yeah, is there anything else that we want to talk about related to like why we do certain things within our dreams? Or does anybody want to even share any dream experiences, or we can just kind of move on to another question? Sky, go ahead.
Sorry, but recently I had a dream about my grandmother who passed away probably 3 years ago. And the whole dream was completely aware. Like, she pulled up in the driveway, and she got into a wheelchair and started wheeling up into her ramp, up the ramp and into her house. And I was with my brother, and she didn't open the door. She went through the door. And I looked back at my brother, and I said, "That's not her. That's her spirit." And later on in the dream, I asked her about it. And she sat down, and at first she tried to deny it, as if, you know, like, you know, you're not supposed to know that stuff. But eventually, me and her actually sat down on her bed, and we started talking in depth about things about, like, how the other side would be and how she is feeling within her new body. And I recall the conversation so clearly. And what you said about interacting and how sometimes they... other beings might channel into our dream as a seeming experience, but that's not really what is happening, you know what I mean? But, like, yeah, I just wanted to share that as, I guess, validation.
Yeah, I think a dream like that is actually a great example of, again, you know, one of the many things that can happen within dreams. But that's very interesting what you were saying, how... again, you know, like within the intelligence of this other spirit, who in this case was your grandmother, like she was almost, it was interesting how you said, like she was trying to like deny it at first. Like I've seen that before within dreams where like, yeah, like the dreamer will sort of start like waking up and having a conversation with the other person, and they're just like, oh, like, oh crap, like they're waking up. But sometimes they're inviting it, you know, they're inviting them to wake up. So, I mean, that just goes into the idea of like what can happen when you do become lucid within a dream. You can actually question characters. You could literally say, you know, like, be like, hey, like, are you a projection of me, or are you something else? And then, you know, they might actually give you an answer. But even then, you almost have to discern it using, like, your heart as sort of, like, a truth meter, so to speak, in a way. Because that's the thing, right? Like, I feel the dream space is constantly, like, this illusion for, over illusion over illusion over illusion. So even if a character, like, literally says, like, be like, oh, yeah, like, I'm totally this or that, you still almost have to, like, you can't just full-on believe it in that moment. Like, maybe you just have to process it with your heart. And this is, like, kind of, like, advanced things in a way. Kiwi, did you want to jump in?
I just wanted to give a quick example that I've had. It was a long time ago, 12 years ago, when I was really practicing lucid dreaming. I got really good at it. I did actually wake up in my dream. I was doing a whole bunch of stuff, but I was on a rooftop, and I was going towards a different place to finish something. I finished off something that happened earlier in the dream, and then there was this old nice lady, and then I realized, and I asked her, how does it feel to be a character in my dream? The answer was kind of disappointed, but she just, because I was building up for a while to be able to actually ask that to a character in my dream, and all she had to tell to me was, it's not your time to know yet. And that's just one example that might spark something. Yeah.
That's a good example. That's a great example. Again, you know, like, it's just really opening up to this other side of like what are dreams to the other entities in a way. You know, like, that's a part that fascinates me. This is something that, and this is sort of alluding to something that I was talking about earlier, but yeah, like, I mentioned in a previous broadcast how I'm starting to think more about dreams as less of just, like, an epiphenomenon of consciousness, but almost more like a specifically designed technology that is integrated into a part of our human body, and our human body is, like, this advanced form of cosmic technology in itself. And, like, so dreams are an extension of this technology. Like, you can almost think of the dream space as a technology, meaning it was something that was, like, systematically created so that we as soul could live as these physical beings yet log into this astral space, like, time and time again every single night. And then if that's the case, if it is something more similar to a technology, you know, I feel like that word is just one of the closest words we can use to describe it, meaning, again, it's been, like, structured, it's been, like, created, it's been, like, it's got, like, a boundary, it's got, like, you know, like, it's like a container, so to speak. And then what I'm finding interesting is that, like, if that's the case, then, you know, maybe are there multiple dream verses, you know, like, do different planets have their own, like, dream internet? You know, you can almost think of the dream space as an internet, you know, it's like the shared network that people are logging into. Caitlin, go ahead.
On that, I think that is actually very a very interesting thought, and I think it's definitely possible, because each planet almost has their own identity, like, their own, well, I mean, I wouldn't know, I've never been to another planet, but I mean, I've thought about it before, and I would think that each planet would have its own almost, like, vibration, and in that, its own identity, this specific feeling. So on the Earth, like, we know what this feels like, and so if we were to go to, for example, maybe the moon with less life on it and less, you know, experience, it would maybe feel more empty. And continuing that into the dream realm, it might be more empty as well. Or it might have more space for us to project ourselves, so maybe we would learn more about our subconscious, like, projection.
I feel like you're referring to dimensional layers of a planet. Like, because Earth exists on multiple dimensions, you know.
So, well, I feel like dreams are different from the third dimension. Like,
oh, yeah, there. Yeah, but dreams extend into the fourth dimension and so on and so forth. So I guess, was that what you were saying? No.
No. No, I was just saying that, like, each planet has its own identity because it's, you know, an entirely different experience.
Therefore having its own experience?
Slightly.
Slightly.
I'll add on to that. You know, like maybe if we think of each planet as its own entity, you know, like each planet as like its own creature. So like each creature has its own mind, and like we're aspects of that hive mind. So in that sense, like, yeah, it would make sense that, again, this is very theoretical, that like different planets have different dream spaces, so to speak, if that's an idea that we kind of want to run with. And I mean, you know, maybe that's something that when we get the chance to like go to Mars, maybe we'll find that our dreams are different on there, or something like that. And another idea that I've always been fascinated by is like the idea that I've always thought about, can another intelligence sentient being who may be very humanoid and live a physical dimensional, third dimensional life on another planet, maybe their role within the galaxy is like when they dream, say theoretically they're like a more spiritually advanced civilization, they might dream at night, and within the night, within the time that they dream, they like interact with our dream space. So like when they go to sleep, they're like, all right, like, honey, I'm gonna go to sleep, and like while I go to sleep, like I'm gonna go like help the humans on Earth, sort of thing, you know. And then they do that, and then they'll actually show up within our dreams as different characters or something like that, you know, like they'll just like appear as maybe one of our friends or a complete stranger or something. And yet, from their conscious perspective, they're actually able to integrate themselves into dreams in a more particular dimension. And this is something that, again, you know, there are stories of people on Earth who talk about being able to enter into other people's dreams intentionally, which, again, you know, like the movie Inception hits upon this, and it's very science fiction. But and Inception's like an interesting movie because I feel it's like hitting on some very potent ideas, at the same time it's like also kind of Hollywoodizing it, which kind of confuses it, but there's some aspects there that are really hitting on some key ideas. And I think one of them is just as a potential topic, like the idea of, you know, back in the day, say there was a shaman, and the shaman actually would have the ability to like go into the dreams of people in the village to be able to help assist them. I like that idea fascinates me. I'll just open up the microphone again if anybody wanted to jump in related to any of that. Otherwise, it's Nikki, go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, so this is what I wanted to ask you guys about. That this experience has happened with me, like, you know, a couple of times, you know, spread out all over different periods of my life. So, and I don't think it was intentional, but as much as I remember, like this thing with entering other people's dreams, it would happen early in the morning. Like I would wake up, usually like around 5 or a bit before or a bit later. But yeah, and I would wake up and I would go back to sleep, and I would see a dream, and then I wake up and I would talk about this, dream. And the other person was like, what? Like, that was my dream. How come? And I was like, yeah, but this happened. And at other times, because, like, this happened a couple of times. And at other times, like, you know, I woke up and I went back to sleep and I was dreaming. And I woke up and I was aware that, oh, this is not my dream. I'm dreaming the dream of the person who's next to me. So, yeah, this has happened with me a couple of times, and I don't know what it is. And I don't think I did it intentionally. And is it astral travel, or was it it? What is it?
Go ahead, Sky. Yep.
I feel like subliminally, well, we have to take into fact that the universe is one, and we are essentially just one giant stream of consciousness. And I feel as if, especially being next to somebody, if that was the case, you just naturally share a lineage, you know? And because you seem to be very intuitive and aware of the frequencies around you without actually being conscious about it, I feel like you have an easier time channeling into the waves that are close to you, you know, because you as a being seem to be very intuitive, and because we are all connected, I feel as if that plays like a really big part in it.
Yeah, I mean, I am intuitive because at times, like, you know, someone would be sitting next to me. I just, like, quite suddenly I would catch what they're thinking and I would have a thought and I'm like, oh, okay. And I would ask the person, is that what you're thinking? And they're like, what? How do you know this? And at sometimes, you know, I would just enter a room and I would know what the other person is thinking and what they're feeling. Like, and it shifts, you know, like when I'm eating more clean and when I'm meditating a lot, I am much more intuitive. And when I'm not, I fall off the wagon and I'm like, you know, not feeling as much.
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, like with dreams, the thing that's really fascinating about dreams is that they're a real barometer of kind of like where we are at physically. You know, when we sort of like raise our vibration within the physical, it definitely has an effect within our dreams. And I think when you think about that, it makes sense that this dream space is almost something that needs to be intentionally worked at. It really is, like, when you start looking at the dream space as like a gift, and almost, I don't want to use the word privilege, but really like a gift. Like, it is something that you have to put the intention towards. And then it makes sense that when you think about a lot of our society these days, so many people just talk about how they don't dream, or at least they don't remember their dreams. I mean, that's the thing. Everybody dreams all the time at night. Whether or not they remember it is a different story. So, I mean, the fact that so many people don't remember their dreams and so many people are sort of tuned into a quote-unquote low vibration of living, and what I mean by that is like also just like the way they treat their body and the things they put into it and just like their own awareness of like their internal energies and everything, and in turn, you know, so many people are just like not able to recall their dreams. So it's important to keep in mind, and I experienced this for myself, that as I change my habits within the physical, as I like refine my willpower, as I make little changes, it does affect my dream space. And it's just part of the path. It's really part of the path where you sort of have to, dreams are a great barometer for sort of like checking in with like where you're at. But again, you know, it's just something that really has to be worked towards, which I think is fascinating. I mean, just as like an update for myself, like I've been keeping a dream journal for the past like month and stuff like that. And just as like a quick tip, again, writing down your dreams is super important. It's like developing a muscle. You know, the dream recall is really just like a muscle, and the more you use it, the better it gets. But within my like dream writing process and everything like that, not all of my dreams, like I haven't really had like super lucid dreams. And even within like the past like couple weeks, like there's some dreams that I can like kind of remember, but compared to like 3 weeks ago, not in the same way. And 3 weeks ago I was kind of like making slightly different choices. And to be honest, I mean, and this is really like just for like, again, you know, everybody has their own experience, and just sharing with you guys, my like main determinary factor as to whether or not I can like vividly remember my dreams is cannabis, like 100%. And like that is, again, you know, something that I'm sharing with you guys just to like remind people listening and encourage them to develop like the willpower to make the choice between, like, you know, do you want to like smoke cannabis during the day or do you want to have an awesome dream at night? And I mean, that, again, you know, is something where for me, like, I'm making those choices on my own, yet through the choices that I'm making, I'm experiencing through my own experience, my like lack of vivid dream recall. And so like that's something that I just have to sort of do within my own path, but I want to be able to just like, yeah, like it's something I'm working towards, and I want to be able to help like lead by example and everything like that. But it's just like it's an interesting topic. It's an interesting fact that like cannabis does have that effect, at least for me at least. But again, there's other factors related to like dream recall and everything. But I know for me, like if I really want to get vivid lucid dreams, like I just have to like not have cannabis in my system for at least like 24 plus hours or 48 hours. And like the longer I don't have it in my system, the more vivid it gets. So that was kind of like what was happening. I was kind of like, you know, like go like a few days without cannabis, and then I would like, you know, use it for a day or whatever, and I don't even use it much at a time. And when I do use it, it's really for like creative purposes or like working out or anything like that. But again, like as soon as I make that choice, it's just kind of like, all right, you know, like I understand that I may not remember my dreams. So again, it's just this real, it's part of my path, and it's been like part of my path, and I feel it's part of a lot of our paths, those of us who work with like the sacred plant medicines as well. But again, you know, this may not be the case for everyone. Some people, just reading John Stockton in the chat, like some people experience the opposite. Some people smoke weed, smoke cannabis, and they actually have like more vivid dreams sort of thing. So everybody's sort of got their own relationship with the dream space, and that's something that I really encourage people to discover. You know, take notes of when you're remembering your dreams better and when you're not, and determine what factors you have within your lifestyle and how those are like affecting your dreams, you know. So you can say like, oh well, I went camping on the weekend and I was away from technology and I was waking up every morning with the sunrise, and that change my dream recall, opposed to like being in front of a computer all day and maybe not exercising as much and getting weird sleep hours. So I mean, that is, it's just an example. But I'm just going to open up the conversation to anybody else. Like, we can talk about that for a minute, you know, like if anybody else wants to share some of their experience with like cannabis and dream recall and how those correlate for you guys, because again, I'd love to be able to learn from you guys as well. Kiwi, go ahead, and then I think Ron had something to share afterwards.
Well, I do believe, let's see, because it's kind of complicated. Okay, so lately I was doing cannabis very frequently, not a lot, but very often, and kind of the minute I stopped was when I had a very vivid dream, and right there I was like, you know what, I'd rather have that dream than the cannabis experience. So I did stop for a while, but I'm trying to remember when I was at my dreaming peak, and I think, and what I'm kind of coming to the realization, I think, is that writing down your dream trumps whether you're on cannabis, because I believe I was doing cannabis when I was at my best dreaming state, and I kind of think I only stopped because honestly, every morning I would be driving. It would take up time in the morning because I would be writing pages and pages of dreams, and that's kind of why I stopped. And yeah, that's just my experience.
Yeah, that's a good point. So I mean, yeah, like can dream recall sort of be trumped by just like other habits such as like good recall and everything? Could someone still smoke cannabis, go to sleep that night, but then regiment their sleep pattern, really make sure they write down their dreams and so forth, and still be able to remember their dreams? That again, you know, it's sort of this variable, but yeah, it's just something to be aware of. John, go ahead. Yep. Kiwi, go ahead, and then John. I thought that was John who said that. Go ahead.
One other thing that helped, I remember one time, is just the easy intention of saying before you go to sleep, focusing on I will remember my dreams. Just saying that, I remember one night, made me remember my dreams with a very strong conviction that an intent to remember your dreams. But I don't think anything trumps the writing. Once you write it, it just, and the detail in the dreams, trying to remember the details and all the little symbols, and then it just exponentially gets better from my experience. That's what I got to say there.
Yeah, I agree. I think the sharing thing definitely brings a huge element into the potential to remember dreams. And John, I'm going to pass over to you in 1 second. I just want to read Brutal Peril, who is in the live chat on the website. And shout out to those of you who are in the team live chat. And again, you know, if you guys are watching live, feel free to jump in the live chat. It's at paradigmshiftcentral.com. You can click the little live chat button there. But he says, don't just write down your dreams, share them. Makes a huge difference. I react differently to cannabis than most people in a lot of ways. Long time since I tried, but I think it tends to enhance the dreams, if any effect at all. But again, you know, what he just said, or what they just said, the idea of not just writing down your dreams, but sharing them. So, I mean, that is like I agree, that's a really important thing. And I've noticed that within like my own practice is that, again, you can find these on my YouTube channel, but I've made a lot of dream log videos. So, I mean, rather than just writing down my dreams, if I can wake up from a dream and share it into a camera, that, for me, is like, it seems to have, like, this snowball effect, where if I do that one night and then I, like, repeat it soon after, it sort of builds on itself. So, I mean, sharing dreams is really great. And again, you know, just reminding people who are already involved with the Paradigm Shift Central website and those of you who may be new, part of the emphasis behind the creation of it is the creation of the quest journals. And the quest journals are used for many things to document your spiritual journey. But in one thing in particular is we encourage people to use the quest journals to use them as dream logs. So, you know, like to sort of have that in the back of your mind that when you're writing down your dreams, you can keep it in mind as like, oh, cool, how can I share this as a potential quest journal for the website and for the community? And again, that helps inspire more people to share their dreams as well. So that's something that I'm looking forward to seeing more within the community, is just like more of us getting into the habit of documenting our dreams. Like literally, you know, like that's the exciting thing. We're documenting our physical realities, but what happens when we start documenting our dream realities with as much emphasis on what it is that they are telling about the bigger story in terms of personal experiences and lessons learned? So that's just one thing I want to share. But John and then Caitlin will pass over to you guys. So you probably had something to say on that. But John, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was going to say that it's the opposite with me. I know I've read articles, and I know that, yeah, you're right. It is a fact that it does, you know, tend to do that. Maybe I'm just weird, but I know I'm weird. I accept I'm weird. That's great. But what I find is that it's how you are using the medicine. So, like cannabis, for example, a lot of people will partake in cannabis with friends, or, you know, they'll watch a movie, or, you know, they'll have cannabis and then they'll do something. And I think that takes all the energy. Like Terrence McKenna talks about how cannabis helps to draw out your dreams, so you can experience dreamlike experiences while you're still awake. And I find that to be true, because when I have a cannabis ceremony, I'm usually in a, you know, dark, quiet place alone, just me and my spiritual guides. And yeah, it feels like parts of my dreams are coming forward, and my dreams are showing themselves to me. And I guess how I can take that into making my dreams more vivid is that even after the feeling of cannabis has faded, spiritually, it's my choice to stay in that spiritual level. And I think that this is also, you know, to do with, you know, like the shamans. Like there's a great movie called Blueberry, and it shows a perfect example of how an initiated shaman can go into another person's experience and heal them from within. And I think there's dreamwalkers that naturally have the ability to go into someone else's dream to help them to deal with something. And I think that cannabis is a way of doing that. It's like a being that can go into your dreams and draw them out for you.
Interesting. Thanks, John. Caitlin and Sky, if you guys wanted to jump in, go ahead.
My first thought was kind of going back to writing down your dreams. Like, I've kept a dream journal since, January. No, it was October of last year, I believe. And it really helps, like, especially writing them down. And it can be time-consuming sometimes in the morning, because if you have, like, a page or two, it can be really time-consuming, and then, like, really remembering all the details. But it really helps, in my personal experience, with, like, remembering them, and then reflecting back upon them, like, really helps as well. And this is actually a thought I had a while ago, but what he just said reminded me of it. When you talk about other beings being in the dreams, like, maybe it could also be, like, concepts that are, you know, manifesting in our dreams as, you know, beings, and it's concepts that we have to confront, or that, you know, maybe we should confront.
Definitely, definitely. Yeah. There's another idea that came up. This is something that I was going to mention before that came up, and it's just something that I'll share with you guys, but I actually shared it in the broadcast that we did with Michelle and Paul Boggy, and I encourage you guys, you can check that out through the main website. Paul's actually beginning a new podcast within the UK time zone, and it's called The Way of Conscious Mindfulness, and again, if you just go to the Paradigm Shift Central website, you can find it under the Quest Journals there. And one of the things that I brought up, because it was actually something that our good friend Eddie Grace had mentioned to me, but it's this idea that in some scenarios, this concept of other entities being able to log into the dream space opens up the idea of potentially, like, non-benevolent entities entering into the dream space as well, and theoretically, like, hijacking dreams. And this gets into the idea of, like, ideas of, like, grays, like, gray aliens. So this is all very theoretical, and I'm just putting it out there just so you guys can sort of, like, think for yourself, and this is by no means, you know, like, the be-all, end-all, but it's this idea that, like, in some cases, gray aliens could, like, infiltrate someone's dream and disguise themselves as a dream character to be able to try to, like, manipulate a person's behavior in some way, or to do something related to their personal agenda or whatever. And so, I mean, like, that idea is, like, kind of daunting, and it's a little bit intimidating, but I sort of think it kind of brings in the importance of us being able to be, like, more conscious and more lucid and more aware within our dreams, so that even if there is a situation like that, we could be able to, like, confront it, we could be able to recognize it, and even just knowing that, like, we are protected in our dream space. And so it's just, like, them kind of trying to play, like, this trickster role within our psychological concepts. But again, like, you can almost approach that open-heartedly as, like, a test. So, I mean, this is, like, the idea of more and more of us becoming lucid within our dreams just incredibly is fascinating to me, because it will allow us to experience moments where we will be tested. You know, we will be tested within dreams. We'll be tested by aspects of ourselves and potentially aspects of, like, outside of ourselves as well. And so, I mean, you know, when we're talking about, like, other entities sort of infiltrating dreams, just keep in mind that it is, like, part of this bigger picture. It is part of, like, this bigger story that's, like, calling us more into what it is that we can do. And to me, it just kind of brings in, like, more reasons as to why we should become lucid, because maybe that's something that actually is happening, and it's just not something that we have the context for. But maybe part of society is actually the way it is, you know, and I'm talking, like, about, like, aggression and anger and greed and all these sort of lower vibrations, because our dreams have actually been infiltrated by, like, non-benevolent entities or something like that. I mean, so again, this sounds like a very, it might, like, make your heart skip a beat or something like that, and I don't know, but I'm just saying, based on the puzzle pieces, it seems to be a theoretical possibility. But again, for me, it just brings in more reason as to why we should become conscious, why we should, you know, sort of look into the idea of, like, becoming light guardians within the dream space, within this space, and bringing, like, peace and bringing, like, calmness and bringing confidence into our own self and into the world as well. But I mean, if you guys have any thoughts on that concept, feel free. Sky, I know you had something to say, so I'll pass it over to you. Go ahead.
I was actually talking to Caitlin before we got on this about a dream that I had where I saw a friend of mine in Walmart, and he was standing in line, and I ran over and I sat on the candy display. And an employee came up to me and said, "You're going to break that." And I looked at her and I said, "That's impossible because we're in an astral realm and these things are not physical matter." And I wasn't conscious of it though, you know what I mean? I said it almost as if it was a subliminal understanding, but later when I woke up I was reflecting on it, and it was kind of like an unconscious moment of consciousness, and I just wanted to know if that has occurred with other people before. Like, it's almost like you recite exactly what's going on, like you recite this perfect understanding, but you know, you're not actually aware that you're dreaming. You just kind of state that you are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really interesting idea when we do that within dreams, where we'll just like drop these aspects of wisdom and then it sort of comes through us, which I think can be really, really exciting and really enriching and nourishing when we do sort of see a part of ourselves that's like tapped into a higher wisdom that's like delivering some sort of cosmic message. And so, I mean, that will happen in dreams where pay attention to the dialogue, pay attention to things that other people are saying, and pay attention to things that you're saying as well. And yeah, like I think that's a good example of just what can happen within dreams where even if we're not lucid, we're still conscious. Like there's still like a part of ourselves that is aware, that is connected, that is understanding of the scenario that is in. Let's continue to open up the conversation, and maybe if we have some more questions, we can bounce around a bit some more. But just going over a couple of the basics, like when it comes to the dream space, like we sort of mentioned it before, you know, aspects of the dream space, basically similar to this physical dimension, but different in the sense of things aren't as dense. It exists through fourth dimension, which we refer to as time, if we want to think about it that way differently, meaning dreams can involve information that exists beyond the present moment into the past and into the future, and that's where you can get into the ideas of like premonitions within dreams, or past lives, or future lives within dreams, or parallel lives within dreams, or lifetimes. And then it also gets into the concept of thoughts creating more instantaneously within dreams. So, I mean, like the physicality within dreams, thoughts instantaneously manifesting, and aspects of time are sort of like the three main things that sort of distinguish the difference between the dream space and what we commonly recognize as the waking state, which, again, from my best guess, is still an extension of the same thing. It's the spiritual realms crystallize into this physical, and the dream space is more sort of like that etheric aspect of the spiritual realms, and the way how things work there are the way how things work here. Here, there are the exceptions to the rule. Here, there are more illusions. Here, there are like more additional elements and rules, quote unquote, that sort of govern it, so that we have this scenario, so that we can live the way we do, and sort of not totally be aware of the fact that we're like incredibly cosmic beings who are creating all the time, and that this world is a reflection of ourselves too. And that's the thing, right? Like even within dreams, when we realize that everything's a reflection of ourselves, that when we see that within our waking state, that's important, right? When we see like why another person came into our life, or if someone triggers something in us, every person's a mirror, right? If someone like makes us angry, that person is there to help us see that anger within ourselves. These are all conversations we can explore in different ways. I just kind of wanted to open it up, going back to like the, again, you know, like we were talking about aliens within dreams and everything like that. This can even get into the concept of sleep paralysis and things, and there's a story that I can actually share about that. And again, you know, lots of people have had experiences of aliens within dreams, and that seems to be like a common thing. That seems to be this idea that, you know, do aliens, when they're talking about abductions and stuff like that, do they just work in the physical, or do they work in the multi-dimensional aspects of the dream space as well? And do people, if people dream of being abducted within a dream, does that actually, like, are in some cases, is that actually like something happening that does involve like another intelligent entity implementing itself into another person's dream space? And, you know, like maybe they have like the awareness, or again, you know, the technology to do that. Again, these are all just concepts, and I'm exploring them alongside you guys, so that's kind of the point of the class, is to just sort of bounce some ideas around and see what we can do. I know Kiwe wanted to mention some things about dreams with aliens, or even John, if you want to talk about that. But Caitlin, I'll pass over to you, since you just put your, if you want to jump in.
Yeah, I just kind of wanted to say, like, as I've noticed that when I dream, I'm much more connected to myself. Like, I'm much more I seem to know myself much better. Like, I just do what I would do without all the, as you said, like, illusions of this, you know, physical reality. And going back to, like, the whole alien thing, I've never, like, personally experienced aliens, but I've in all my dreams, like, I talk to people and I interact with people, or, like, I don't know if they're real people or myself or concepts or whatever. And I feel like with aliens, it could either be, like, I don't know, like, I never have a set answer or opinion for anything, really. But it could be them, like, appearing in our physical world, like, maybe under a disguise or under one of those illusions. And then our dreams trying to, like, let us know, like, hey, this is what's going on. You know, like, open your eyes a little bit more, because time seems to go almost faster in dreams. And, or it could be, you know, the exact opposite, like, where they appear in our dreams. And, like, that's kind of telling us that they're in our physical reality. And it's kind of the same thing, but then again, it's kind of not. Like, I don't think I'm explaining it properly. But it's just, like, a passing thought that I had about that.
Yeah, it is an interesting topic to talk about, because it's sometimes, like, hard to put words on it, definitely. But, yeah, again, you know, like, that's part of the reason for this class, is the fact that we acknowledge that we don't know everything. You know, this dream space, the dreams, they are very mysterious. They are very, you know, new to a lot of culture. Like, I mean, oftentimes talking and discussing what dreams are has been something kept in secret and something, you know, kept, like, hidden, and very few people would be aware to talk about it. So, I mean, you know, we're amongst sort of the vanguard when we're just, like, trying to understand what's possible within the dream space. And so that's why, like, I wanted to bring in the idea of, like, other entities, like, being able to access dreams, because, again, it's just trying to understand what is possible. But, again, for me, that doesn't... The idea of other entities being able to access dreams doesn't necessarily always mean a negative thing. In some ways, it can be very much mean a positive thing as well. The idea that there are, like, other sentient, conscious intelligences who are also interacting with us within our dream and who are also helping us as well. Okay, we'll let Sky go, and then Kiwi and John, if you have anything to jump in afterwards, just feel free and let me know. But Sky, go ahead.
I always felt like if I were in a waking state and say to interact with a higher being, I would be really intimidated, you know? And I feel like maybe that's a big reason why they have to take form of something else. Not only to identify themselves as something we are familiar with and recognize, but also, I mean, think about an alien and, like, how you would feel if you physically saw one with your eyes and, like, it was trying to interact with you. I'd feel pretty intimidated just from the unknown, you know? The concept, you know, of other beings, like, say a being looks in a way that we aren't familiar with, that doesn't look like a human, maybe it would just freak us out to the point that we wouldn't listen to the message that they're trying to convey, you know, and that's just a passing thought, something I wanted to speak on.
I think what you hit on there is actually really key. It just reiterates, like, the logic behind, yeah, like, if another entity is going to come into our dreams, they're going to do it in a way where they can appear so that there's, like, comfort between us and them, so that we can have the language and experience the message. And then again, you know, this is very common between stories that we hear about with near-death experiences, when we hear about, you know, like, people being greeted by loved ones as they sort of pass over and before they come back, sort of thing. And then in some cases, you know, like, are those actually loved ones? Or maybe it's, like, the form of, like, a higher intelligence appearing as a loved one, but yet it still is a loved one. And it's interesting because we even see this in the movie Contact with Jodie Foster from back in the day. You know, she, like, goes through this wormhole into another dimension, sees another planet, and then she's on that beach scene, and, you know, it's like a cosmic beach, and she's standing there, and she's talking to what she sees as her father, yet ultimately, like, it even says, you know, it's just like, no, like, I'm not your father, but we're here just so that, you know, you'll be able to find comfort in this interaction. So, I mean, the dream space, you know, it's this cosmic thing. Like, literally, you know, we can see other planets, and we can see other dimensions, and we can experience interactions with other entities. And that's where I feel, you know, when we're talking about, like, alien contact, like, we need to keep in mind, like, what the dream space is opening up to. And I think if more people took it seriously, we would sort of begin to be bridging relationships between ourselves and the bigger cosmic civilizations that are out there. But it's a very personal thing, and again, you know, like, it's not one of those things where someone can tell you. It's one of those things that you have to experience yourself. But as we become more sovereign and more conscious, it allows us to be better students of our dreams. And as we do that, you know, maybe these higher intelligent entities are actually like picking and choosing, be like, okay, like, this person is awake enough to be able to get something out of an experience that we can bring to them, and not even that, but potentially be able to bring it into the physical, you know. So I mean, that's something where, as all of us continue to write down our dreams, like, yes, when we have, those ideas excite me, the ideas of like someone waking up and be like, guys, like, yeah, like, I had a crazy dream last night where I was talking to a quote-unquote alien or something like that. Like, when those happen, those are meaningful, and those are worth documenting, and I think that is where a lot of this, like, quote-unquote first contact is going to be occurring, is actually within the dream space, if we start thinking about it that way. So, I mean, yeah, there's a lot there to explore. Kiwe or John, did one of you guys want to jump in? I see you guys chatting in the side chat with some cool points there. Kiwe, go ahead.
Just a personal experience. Maybe it might spark someone's mind. So one dream that I do remember myself when I was living in New York, and I would take the bus a lot. So my dream was, I was on the bus and an alien was trying to get on the bus. Everyone didn't notice, like, if it was anything weird. The alien didn't have enough change, so I went up and I paid for the alien to get on the bus. He sat, and or she sat, and I don't remember everything we really talked about, but I think the first thing that the alien said to me was, "You're Jacob." And just a simple, whether it be an actual alien or if it was a manifesto in my mind or whatever it was, but that those simple words have resonated in my waking life, if this is the waking life. Whereas that next day, in the morning, there was a show actually on Jacob, and I would not have paid attention to it. And I had a lot of insights from having that more attentive mindset towards it. And even 10 years into the future, I remember after a paradigm shift meeting with you guys and talking with, I believe it was Dave, and he was talking about the Jacob's ladder and the deep meaning in that Jacob story, which is huge. And even furthermore, within the 3 weeks, I'm just making a connection, because Jacob's big thing is he was battling with an angel, or they actually argue whether it was battling with an angel or battling with God himself. I can't remember exactly, but I can relate to that, where it's like saying, surrendering and doing the will of God, the will of the universe through us, instead of fighting that. And I have kind of been, I think, being better by doing that, and I've noticed so many more signs that it really amazes me how often these signs are popping up, because I seem to be on that path. And I know you remember that one paradigm shift meeting where we were talking, how do you know you're on that path? And what we talked about in that meeting has been in my reality of late. And you can say all of that could have been by a few words by an alien character in a dream over a decade ago. So another little spark I would like to say is, if any of you guys had any experiences where, like, you had a dream and then that dream kind of, in your waking life, something happens that's directly correlated, seems directly correlated to that dream. It's like a synchronistic happening, if it is a synchronistic happening between dream and waking life. But yeah, that's what I want to say.
Yeah. Yeah, that's that again, you know, is like a great thing to document the synchronicities between dream experiences and waking life, and something we mentioned at the top of the show. If anybody wants to say something about that, we can get into that. Or maybe John, if you just want to share something, but definitely I appreciate you sharing that QA because that's a really interesting point. John, go ahead though, whatever you want to share.
Oh yeah, sure. Gosh, a couple years ago, I had a dream where I was training with some Jedi figure, and then not too long after that, I would say either a week or a month, I had another dream where I was in some sort of room with a gray. It was actually, it was more white than gray, but he handed me this drink, and somehow I knew we were friends, like we're like past, like we've been friends for a long time for some reason. It's like I just knew it, even though I didn't know his name or recognize him in any way. It was like there was just this like spiritual recognition. And anyway, I took the drink, and then I saw that it was just a Starbucks cup, and I saw the Starbucks logo, and then I remember waking up after that. What was interesting is that dream then got me into researching Starbucks, which then led me into researching fluoride and led me into researching, you know, how these chemicals are in our food, and they harm our meditation. They you know, calcify the pineal gland, which is related to dreaming and journeying and pretty much meditation. And so it's very important to keep that healthy. And that was kind of like, it was like whatever that being was that gave me that drink, in a way, it helped. However, after that, my dreams were no longer showing the Jedi guy, and they were no longer lucid. They were vivid, but they were no longer lucid. Like before that, I was able to dream and be like, oh, I'm dreaming, and just, you know, watch myself dream. I was just starting out with deep trance meditation as well. This was about 5 years ago. So yeah, I just thought I'd share that.
Yeah, that was the one that you made the quest journal about, was it not?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, so if people want to see that, they can browse through the old archives in the quest journal and check out what Ron wrote about that one. But yeah, that's interesting. Thanks, John. And Caitlin, we'll pass it over to you guys.
So the dreams correlating with, you know, like physical experiences a while ago, it was probably not like too long ago, like not more than 6 months ago, I don't believe. But I had a dream, and it was a very like short, simple dream. Like I was just outside, I believe, and there was like a ladybug like crawling on my arm and on my hand. And like that was literally all the dream was me observing this ladybug for like just a few minutes is what it felt like. And then the next morning I woke up like from the dream, and I went to the bathroom, like in the bathroom. And the same, like, color ladybug, there was, a ladybug in the bathroom, like, on the sink area. And it was, like, the same colors in my dream and everything. And I just figured I'd share that because it's very interesting to me.
Yeah, again, just, like, another, that's simple, but, I mean, like, again, you know, even with it not needing to be super profound, it still was just, like, making you notice it. It was just like, huh. Like, you know, like that's interesting. So I mean, without needing to be like this elaborate story or whatever, it's just like here's something in a dream, here's something there. Therefore, it makes you question, like, you know, are these two worlds connected, sort of thing. And definitely, I would say so. Yeah, I want to get more into some of the topics of like how dreams sort of fold over into this reality. And we'll definitely go there. And I'm sure, you know, we got a few more questions we can sort of generate with the group. And I want to take some time to just acknowledge anybody in the live chat. If anybody in the live chat has any questions, please feel free to share those as well. And even just before we do that, I just want to give a shout out and a welcome to a new player has joined the game. So Dustin, welcome to the game. You can test your microphone. Say hello.
Hey, what's up?
Hey.
I've been trying to join for a while, but my phone was being weird.
Awesome. Well, welcome here, man. And I know you were tuned into the broadcast, and you might have heard earlier we were sort of starting off just by allowing people to just introduce themselves and share a little bit about why they're here. So if you'd like to do that now, by all means, man. What brings you to Dream Class?
Well, I mean, I've always been into dreaming. And, I mean, it's just been a big part of my life for, like, 4 years. I guess you could say I used to be narcoleptic, and that's kind of a long story, but lots of dreams when you fall asleep all the time. And so, yeah.
Cool. Is there anything in particular that you might want to learn more about related to dreaming? It's a big thing.
Yeah, it is a big thing. Loaded question. I'm kind of just here to see, like, what comes up, and then, like, you know?
Word. Awesome. Cool, man. Well, welcome to the class, and at any point, if you have anything to share, you can just kind of, like, raise your hand and jump in on that. So,
okay.
Cool. Just going back to Caitlin and also Dustin, just when you're not talking, if you can just manually mute your microphone as well, that would just... Perfect. Caitlin, just going back to what you were talking about, the ladybug, again, you know, when animals show up in your dream, it is always worth noticing, like, what that animal was, because, you know, like, every animal sort of has an energy, it has, like, a teaching aspect to them. So, I mean, Peril was just mentioning in the chat, literally just saying, you know, maybe that ladybug really was an entity you should pay attention to. So, I mean, that may be something for you to just, even though that dream sounded like it was a while ago, but the fact that you're mentioning it here connects it again, but maybe just take the time to look up a little bit about the animal teachings of a ladybug. See what it is that might be in there for you. Maybe there's something that you can learn from it, sort of thing. And maybe, who knows, you might start seeing it again, and who knows, like, that could almost be like a trigger, a reality check. And that in itself is, of course, another topic that, you know, I'd love to be able to explore, and we can bring it into this class as well, the concept of just, like, reality checks. And I know Sky was actually mentioning this, I think it was before the broadcast, but just, you know, what are reality checks? And I'll just introduce this real quick, but again, you know, there's a few topics we're kind of circling around at the same time right now. But reality checks are physical habits that you do within your waking state that will sort of bleed over into habits that you repeat within your dream state, that will allow you to activate a shift in awareness so that you can become more conscious and potentially lucid within the dream state. Some of the obvious ones, and again, we've mentioned these in past broadcasts, but, you know, some of the obvious ones are trying to pull your finger. So you say every time you can set an alarm, maybe every hour, you want to make it a habit, you try pulling your finger. And then within the physical, it's obviously solid, but within the dream state, you pull your finger and it might stretch, and that sort of gives, like, this oh my god, what the hell moment, but that can be like, wow, okay, I'm dreaming right now. But again, you know, this is something, to be honest, reality checks is something that I don't want to use the word struggled with, but it's just something that I know I haven't fully put as much attention into as I could, and I feel like the thing that would make a difference for me would be, like, by having an alarm clock that reminded me to do reality checks, because personally, like, I know that, like, I don't utilize reality checks as well as I could have, and that's something that I know I can still bring into my practice. And again, you know, there's a lot of different ways to do reality checks. Another simple one would be every time you walk through a door, look up at the ceiling. And oftentimes you'll notice that within dreams, the ceiling may not be there. Which is a very interesting thing that, like, within dreams, it's kind of like a video game where it kind of only renders, it only produces what it needs to. So if there's, like, a corner in your dream and you, like, look around it too fast, you may actually, like, see a glitch within the dream where, like, it hasn't, like, loaded it before you looked at it, kind of thing, which again sort of goes back to this idea of just, like, you know, like, are we working with the technology here, you know, and are there ways to sort of hack it and sort of, like, access the console code where you can, you know, unlock God mode and no clip and flight mode sort of thing, you know, and load up new levels. And to be honest, I think it is. Like, I literally think it is. And you access this console mode. This is sort of an old video game reference. A console mode is something that would, like, drop down if you're playing, like, Counter-Strike or something, and you could type in, like, /, like, no clip would allow you to, like, float through walls or something like that. So, I mean, within a dream, this concept can apply and can allow you to, again, you know, like, access that ability to fly through walls within a dream just by thinking about it, because it's your thoughts that lead to it. Yeah, God mode. So, yeah, but again, reality checks is something we can get into, and I'm going to open up the mic and see if anybody else has some suggestions on reality checks. Before we do that, I just want to say a shout-out to Nikki. Nikki, it sounds like you're about ready to head off into the astral. If you'd like to say farewell, please feel free to do that before you leave, and thanks again for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'm really tired now. I'm gonna go dream. All ready to dream now. So yeah.
Cool. Thank you. All right. Well, we'll see you in the astral. So take care.
See ya. Bye.
See ya. Cool. Okay. So yeah, I'll pass it over on related to reality checks or anything else. But Dustin, go ahead if you wanted to jump in.
Yeah, I do. For me, like reality checks. For me, it's when I look at my hands. Whenever I just happen to see my hands in my dream, it kind of just like makes everything click, and I just become like super aware of everything and like really lucid and stuff. And it varies about how long that lucidity lasts, but everything's like super real. And it all starts with like looking at my hands and just seeing how real my hands are. That's how I do my reality checks whenever that happens to happen.
So every time that you sort of consciously look at your hands in your waking state, you sort of, what do you do? Do you like ask yourself if you're dreaming, or do you want to just like elaborate?
Yeah, so like I would, whenever I'm awake or whatever, and I see my hands, I'll just be like, you know, is this a dream? And I know it's not, but I ask myself and get that habit. And so then when I'm actually dreaming and I look at my hands, I'll ask myself, is this a dream? And I'll be like, yeah, it's a dream. And from there, it's like I'm lucid and I just do stuff, whatever I feel like doing. But by that point, I guess there's so many options, I don't know what to do. So, yeah.
That's cool. And how long have you been doing that, and how frequently does that work for you?
Since like 8th grade. And it's since 8th grade. So even now, it's like, it still works, you know. I don't do it all the time because it just happens. Like I don't, while I'm dreaming, I don't purposely bring out my hands, but when it does happen, it happens. I think I'm just so used to lucid dreaming now that I'm good at seeing when it's a dream and when it's not. I'll be right back, though.
Okay, no problem. Yeah. Yeah, that's, again, you know, we can get back to Dustin once he returns, but Caitlin, Sky, did you guys want to jump in? I think I saw you guys.
I just personally wanted to say that, even if he's not here to hear it, that is just something that I've actually heard of, and that is why I brought up the whole reality checks thing. It almost acts as an initiator element to realize that you're dreaming. You know, like, you become so consistent in these habits, such as pulling your finger, looking at your hands, looking up in doorways, things like that, like, because they are so habitual, they carry into the spiritual realm, or astral realm, I guess, not spiritual realm, but, or both. Either way, that's not the point. I just wanted to say yet another example of how our physical reality and the dream reality can sort of bleed into one another.
Yeah, that, and I feel like anything you do that makes an imprint on your life physically, like physically in an energetic way, like it makes an energetic footprint or imprint on your physical life. I feel like anything like that could really be potentially in your dreams very often, because it's something I've personally noticed. When I put a lot of like even mental or emotional intention or anything into something, it tends to happen more frequently in my dreams as well.
Yeah, those are some good points. And again, it goes back to the simple idea that, like, as you think, so shall you become. What you focus on grows, energy flows where your attention goes, kind of thing. So, yeah, like, the reality checks, like, they don't necessarily have to be complicated. Like, I think that's the important thing. It's just finding one that works for you. And to be honest, again, like, that's still something that even just us talking about here does inspire me and does remind me as to like how I can begin using that, because I as much as I'm aware of reality checks, it honestly hasn't been something that I've like fully brought in properly to my practice, and it's just because I haven't like done it properly within my waking state. So I just need to develop my own method to be able to do that. But again, you know, like there's a lot of other ways to do reality checks. I'll just share an example, and then you know we can share some more examples. One example that I had from a guy who I met, his reality check was looking at his shoes. And within his dream state, his shoes would be like red, but within reality, they were actually green. So when he would look at his shoes within his dream state, he'd be like, wait a second, my shoes aren't red. Oh, I'm dreaming. That's right. And then like, but he would literally like do that consecutively sort of thing. So again, you know, like the concept of reality checks is something that can get really creative. If pulling the finger thing doesn't really work for you, try something else. You know, like there's the jumping up and down thing that may work for some, but again, you know, try something else. And I think the hands one does work, but again, you know, it's asking questions and it's bringing conscious awareness into the present moment. So I mean, whenever you are doing a reality check, sometimes it can be good just to like connect that with the practice of breathing and bringing mindfulness into that present moment. And so again, you know, you just, that is like part of how we can work towards lucid dreaming, is just by bringing more mindfulness into our present state. So, you know, we're more aware of like taking those moments consciously to be like, hey, what does the air feel like right now? You know, like what do I smell right now? And even Peril was talking in the chat of really bringing in texture. So like focusing on touching things. So, I mean, you can do that within waking state, you know, just casually touch things. And then they were saying that, you know, touching things and focusing on the texture in dreams can really ramp up lucidity for them. So, does anybody else want to share any other reality check things that you can do? Okay, John and then Sky, go ahead.
Hey, so I have tried pretty much all the techniques you mentioned. I tried pulling the finger. And I pulled my finger out, and it was kind of like a loop, and I was like, wow, that's really cool. And I just stayed in the dream. Like, I didn't realize I was dreaming. I just thought it was awesome. I could pull my finger. Another one is the looking up, and I would look up, and I saw I was indoors, but I could see the stars, like the cosmic universe. And I just thought that was really cool, and just staying on my dreams. So I guess my question is even after doing the reality checks, how do you then tell yourself that it's a dream and it's not just a really cool ability? Because the one time that I actually did tell myself, oh, yeah, wow, I'm actually dreaming, is I saw a dog that passed away walk by, and I was like, that's my dog. He passed away. This is a dream. And then I was like, oh crap, this is a dream. I guess I'm going to fly now. So I jump up in the air, and because I jumped up in the air, my body shook and I woke up.
That's that's another example. Sky, passing it over to you guys. We'll keep rolling.
That kind of coincides perfectly with what I was about to say. I noticed that when I start to become more conscious in my dreams, it like almost jolts me. Like I wake up really fast and really like disappointed that I'm back in this reality. Because I've had moments like that too. Like for example, with my grandma being in my dream. I don't exactly take it as an indicator that it's a dream. I just kind of accept the fact that somehow we've managed to bring her back to life, and this is just the way it is, you know. But when I do have those moments of like consciousness that I'm dreaming, I can't stay in them for long. Like I've had moments in my dreams where I control them. Like for example, I had a dream where I was climbing through a house and I needed a ladder, so I just thought of a ladder. Like I was like, oh yeah, I can just think of one. And so I did, and it just spawned, and I used it and whatnot. But that really is only one of very few instances that I was able to stay in a dream while I was conscious that I was dreaming, because most of the time I just kind of wake up.
Yeah, I was just going to say that's a topic in itself and a reason. A common thing that happens within dreams is that when we do achieve lucidity, it can be very common for us to like wake up suddenly or to almost be like overwhelmed with like the excitement. We're just like, oh my God, I'm lucid. Like, I made it. And then you get so excited that you wake yourself up. And one of the reasons, one of the ways as to how we can sort of govern this mindfully is to practice meditation during our waking state so that when we do become lucid within a dream state, we can just like chill ourselves out and like take a breath and literally like meditate within the dream space and just kind of knowing that it's like this very fragile thing. And if we're like too excited, yeah, like we could wake ourselves up, but if we like lose focus, then we can like slip back into the dream. So it's like you're like walking like a tightrope when you're sort of in that lucid dream state. And that's where it really brings in this idea of like, it does take like acute awareness. And some people, again, you know, they talk about lucid dreaming by accident or by default and stuff like that. But for the majority of us, it really is something that takes focus, it takes intention, it takes willpower. But the rewards of it are phenomenal. You know, it's experiencing this whole nother level of dimension that equally is valuable within this reality because of the experiences and the learning and the knowledge that we gain from it. So yeah, I'm just there's a lot of other things that I definitely want to get into, but I just want to open up the microphones again if anybody else wants to talk about anything. Kiwi, go ahead.
Just wanted to quickly say I completely agree with the meditation and how it could help you in the dream state with focus. I kind of correlated it to like emotional intelligence because I think that's kind of key, and I think maybe that's how our waking state can obviously correlate to the dream state. And if you can be more in control of your emotions, because I think emotions is the thing that really sets it up and can jolt you up. But if you can be kind of not possessed by your emotions, not over, your mind be overpowered by your emotions, and you always be in that power state, then I think obviously you can stay in to lucid dream longer. I just thought it's really kind of emotions. But yeah, that's it.
Cool. Does anybody else want to jump in on anything? Feel free. Again, what are some other reality checks that we might want to share or mention or ideas? Sky, go ahead.
I heard one that was, it said, if you wear a watch and you consistently look at the watch, not to check time, but to look at the numbers, because apparently, if, and this may be based completely on somebody else's experience, because this is not an experience that I've had. I'm like you in that situation. I'm very aware of the reality checks, but I don't really use them much. But I also heard one that if you have a watch on and you look at it when you're in a dream, it won't be numbers. It'll be something entirely different because there is no time in the fourth or in astral dimension. So, you know, there really is no measurement of anything. It just is what it is. And when you look at your watch, you kind of just experience something otherworldly, I guess, would be a good one.
Yeah, that's another thing about the dream space is that it seems that like writing, anything with sort of like writing and stuff like that is like glitched out for whatever reason. Sorry, I'm just doing something. Try that one. FYI, for people who were trying to join the live chat or trying to join the Hangout, they may have found that one of the links that I posted was directing them to a wrong place. Just go back to the live chat on the main website and you can find the most recent link that I posted in there, or click the Join the Hangout button within the main link on the website, within like the actual Paradigm Shift Dream Class June 14th. Page. But again, just inviting people to feel free to join in. We still got more in this class. But yeah, like that, you're right. Like, that's a really interesting, again, observation as to the characteristics of the dream space. One of the things being is that like writing is very glitchy within the dream space. So that can be a thing where if you see something within the dream that has like, again, you know, Sky was talking about like a clock or anything like that. Try like getting up close to it and observing it and try reading it, and then your inability to read it will be like, oh my God, this is so glitchy. But then that could be a trigger. That could be a way for you to activate more lucidity as well. Yeah, does anybody else want to share with anything, or we can totally begin to open things up into a new realm with a new question, and we'll wrap this broadcast up no more than another hour, so we'll put a cap on it, and we'll just keep things moving along, though, but I really appreciate, again, everybody, thank you so much for joining in, for being a part of this. This is it's always fun, it's always exciting, and, you know, even if topics sort of come up time and time again within a dream class, it's always relevant because, you know, we're constantly, like, we're at a new point, and the topics may sort of, like, our perception of the topics is changing. So that's why we want to go back to them time and time again, because we're constantly changing. John, I think you had your mic opened. If you want to jump in with anything, feel free, or if anybody else wants to jump in. John, go ahead.
I was wondering if the beings that you see within a dream, when I see it, I have pretty vivid dreams, and I see that there's, like, if I could think of it, like, three categories of beings. You got the beings that are just there, you know, like human beings, or, you know, whatever dream space you happen to be on at the time, but they're just as oblivious as you are as far as dreaming, like, as if they don't even understand it's a dream. They think it's reality. Then you got these other beings that are kind of like jokester, trickster, I guess you would call them trickster beings, but they're kind of like, they're just kind of playing with you. And then you got these other beings that are like, I guess some would call, like, benevolent beings, like Mother Mary comes to give you a marshmallow or something like that, you know, or even if, you know, not even deities. I just use Mother Mary for example, but, like, you know, it could be a blue fairy or something. But it's definitely not human, and it's not oblivious to you. Like, it is aware that you are there. Anyway, I'm thinking if any reactions to those beings can trigger you into realizing that you're dreaming.
Sorry, do you want to just ask that? Was that a question you were asking? Can you just rephrase that, maybe?
Yeah. I'm just wondering if the trigger could be the beings or the people that you were interacting with inside the dream. Could those act as triggers? Like, has anybody ever experienced a being saying, "You're dreaming"?
That's a really interesting idea. I'd love to hear some things about that. And again, you know, like the concept of, like, of asking other characters within a dream whether or not they even know their dream characters is, like, a really interesting conversation itself. And just to quickly just branch off, one thing that you can actually do within shared dreams that I've heard about is, like, some people will go up to another person who's, like, a sleepwalking in their dream, and they'll, like, try to wake them up. So, I mean, you know, like, maybe that will happen. Maybe Sky and Caitlin, if you guys, like, have a shared dream, maybe one of you will have to, like, wake the other one up and be like, Caitlin, or Sky, like, you're dreaming right now. Like, we made it. But then, like, you know, this is just a scenario. But then one of them would just be like, no way, man. Like, no, we're not. This isn't a dream at all, man. Like, totally. Just like, no, you're dreaming. And you're going to have to, like, shake them and wake them up. And again, you know, it's just kind of like, like, they still have that virtual reality headset on. You almost have to, like, take it off, and then it's just like, oh, my God. But yeah, like, that's almost like a parallel within this waking state where some people, you know, they're sleepwalking through their waking state. And, yeah, you have to, like, sort of shake them to wake them up. And so you do that. There's parallels between the dream state story and this state story, I feel. But, yeah, the kind of going back to what John was saying, if anybody's ever had a dream character tell them that they were dreaming or anything like that, I'd love to hear about that or anything else. But, Caitlin, go ahead.
A while ago, I did have a dream character tell me that I was dreaming, and at the time, I was very close with the person, and it was actually a very, like, dark time of my life, and it's kind of odd that I experienced it, in my opinion, now looking back, but he told me, and, like, I remember, like, his exact words. He was like, "You're dreaming, you know, you can't move like you do in the physical reality. You have to think it more than, like physically move your muscles. Like, it's not muscle memory, it's your mind." And I just wanted to...
I have a question for... I'm sorry, I can't remember who brought up the idea, but, like, dream characters and their presence,
especially more mystical beings, and their presence kind of triggering you to realize that you're dreaming. Were you referring to a feeling that their presence brings? You know, like you feel something and it kind of just triggers, I guess. I'm not really doing what I'm trying to say justice with my words right now, but yeah.
John, go ahead if you have a direct response to that. And no, I think I understood what you were saying, so.
Okay. What I was saying is that you actually see. I mean, with our inherited psychic abilities, some people are telepathic, some people are empathic. We all journey differently. A lot of people see visualization after visualization. You know, there's just tons of visions and beauty and everything. Other people just feel everything. Like other people they can feel it, but they don't see it. And I guess without picking one of those in particular, since we are talking about dreaming and dreaming is really visual, I guess I mean if you see the being, like if you see the blue fairy or you see the white rabbit or whatever it is. Like a lot of people talk about angelic, beings that appear to them in their dreams or, or we were talking about earlier, aliens, but yet we as humans, we don't necessarily, we put aliens in a box. We try to label it. So, it could be benevolent, but yet our own view can see it as malevolent and therefore, limiting the experience. So that's why I was, using angels as an example. But yeah, I guess I meant seeing.
I guess that kind of goes back to what we were saying about how sometimes when we're in a dream and something unusual pops up, we tend to just accept it as reality instead of realize that we're in a dream. I guess it kind of just depends on the moment. And I like what someone said too earlier in the chat. They said it's not your time to know yet. Like if it's your time to know that, you're dreaming and actually tap into that, I guess you could say, ability to recognize it, then more so you're probably likely to recognize that you're dreaming based off seeing another being. But at the same time, you may not be ready and it may just be dismissed as reality somehow in some unexplainable way. You just accept it.
Yeah. Again, it's interesting to sort of acknowledge that, yeah, we really have to sort of like trust the dream space and not be frustrated by it. If we feel like, why didn't I see this? Or why didn't I get that? Knowing that there is, if you want to think about it this way, some sort of like higher governing aspect that you're right is sort of directing what comes up to us in the dreams and what we become aware of and everything. But again, it's like you only see what you're ready for kind of thing. And kind of going back to what you were asking before, Sky, and then I'll pass over to you, Caitlin, when you were talking about like higher, like other entities and things like that. Again, I think it's like the presence can be a very heartfelt presence. It's like seeing them with your heart that can sort of, it's almost like you're like reading their aura with your heart can be one way of sort of determining like what is this entity, like is it just like another dream character reflection or is it like something else that has a presence, and I mean it may be one of those things where like it could go right past you and you'll never really fully you may never actually know. And again, maybe in some cases you're not actually supposed to know, but yeah, in a ideal dream scenario where like everything is lucid, yeah, we sort of have to think about like the tricks and tips as to how we can use our modalities to acknowledge and like decipher our dream space around us. And I feel one of them is like using the heart to listen to like the energies of another entity and sort of say like, okay, like, you know, this is, whereas if it was just a dream character, maybe it would be like a low vibration, almost like an AI character within, you know, like a scenario. But then if it was like another intelligent entity, it would have like a vibrance to it, you know, like a light or something like that. You know, these are kind of words trying to describe a concept within the dream space. But yeah, that could be, I think, yeah, just being able to listen with your heart. And again, this is something that we can practice in our day-to-day life. If you're, like, meeting a stranger for the first time, listen with your heart, because maybe that will say, like, hey, you know, like, maybe you should hang out with this person more, or maybe it should say, maybe you should hang out with this person less, you know, sort of, like, helps guide you in that way. It's that inner intuition that does have access to, like, more information than what you normally perceive with like your regular senses. So it's like tapping into that additional sense. So yeah, the heart is the heart is an intelligence in itself. The heart is the heart is eyes and ears as well. We don't just see with, like, we don't just see with your eyes and ears. Don't just see and hear with your eyes and ears. Like, listen with your entire body, see with your entire body. And that can apply to the dream state. And again, keeping in mind that we don't even have physical bodies within the dream state. We just imagine that we do. So, I mean, that's a whole conversation itself, and that gets into, like, you know, like, being able to morph and different abilities. But going back to Caitlin, I know, sorry, you had your hand up a minute ago if you wanted to jump in with anything, or go ahead.
Yeah, kind of what you just said reminded me of something. I read this book, The Divine Matrix, by, what was it, Greg Braden. I don't know if you guys have heard of it, but it's really good. Anyways, he mentioned a experiment done in there that by HeartMath, where they like tested the heart kind of, and they've kind of proved or found that it actually has like an electromagnetic, you know, field that is very like it can really affect a lot of things. And I thought that was just an interesting tidbit. And also going back to what we were talking about like a while ago was the writing and how like I remember this one time in a dream I saw like it was almost like a scroll, but I knew that it was very like it was very important and it was almost like a sacred piece of text, and I remember trying to read it and I couldn't, like it was a bunch of gibberish and symbols and it had no meaning whatsoever to my conscious mind, like even now. And I just thought that was, I just wanted to share that because I think it goes also connects to when you're not ready for something maybe, and so it just doesn't appear as perfectly clear.
Mm-hmm, sure. So anybody else want to jump in on the topic of being able to like recognize other entities in your dreams? I can share with you guys again, you know, opening it up first, but there's a story that I want to share with you guys of like a sort of sleep paralysis encounter with a potential gray that I had within a dream one time that was pretty visceral that I can share with you guys. It's kind of scary actually, but in a way worth sharing. Dustin, go ahead.
Yeah, so I'll start with the whole recognizing people in dreams. There are times where like I noticed that I'm not talking to like a mindless dream character, and I am talking to like some sort of being, and it's usually the vibe. You get some sort of vibe. I can't describe it, but you kind of just know, at least I do in my dreams, that this is some sort of not dream character, but some real thing that I'm interacting with. I get that vibe sometimes. And in regards to sleep paralysis, that is really, really scary. I don't get it as much anymore. And it definitely helps not to be scared, for sure. But, yeah, I think I've had experiences, many different sleep paralysis experiences, where, like, I'll start off in a dream and become aware that I'm dreaming or something, or that I'm interacting with this being, and it'll switch over to, like, sleep paralysis mode, where, like, there's actually, I'm kind of half awake, half asleep, and I can actually see, like, something, you know, interacting with me in some way of some sort, you know? And I usually just wait it out, but that happens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, sleep paralysis, I feel it is something that, you know, probably everyone will experience at least a couple times within their lifetime, and it is worth just sort of
I thought it was being quieter.
talking about to to sort of be able to like grasp our head around like what is happening and everything. So I mean, I'll share with you guys a quick sleep paralysis story that I had. And again, you know, like when it comes to sleep paralysis, it seems to be in this case where the mind is awake but the body is asleep, which is actually like a very common process of falling asleep. Like that's usually what happens. Usually what happens when you fall asleep is like your mind goes to sleep and then your body goes to sleep. But if you meditate, and this is where you can get into like practices of astral projection, and you do things to keep your mind awake as you're falling asleep, your body will fall asleep, your mind stays awake, and then you can either go right into a lucid dream, or potentially it could like become like sort of something similar to a sleep paralysis experience. But again, sleep paralysis can occur from within the sleep state, and you sort of like half wake up, but again, like your mind wakes up, your eyes even may open, but your body is still asleep, which disconnects you from your ability to move it, which for a lot of people can sort of be this fear-inducing thing, again, just because they don't really have a understanding and concept, and all they know is just like, oh my god, why can't I move my body? What the hell? This is scary. You know, and some people are just like, am I dead or something like that? It can get very, very overwhelming very fast. But ultimately, you know, like if it is like if anybody does go into sleep paralysis, you know, even from here on in the future, really just even just from this information alone, just like try to bring calmness into it as much as you can, and just connect with your breath and be really calm, and you know, allow it to pass. And also to even be able to observe it, because you're definitely going to be in sort of like this like in-between state. And yeah, there may be like a particular lesson there for you. And again, you know, it's a conversation we're still exploring as we continue to go. So I'll just share my quick experience. I've only had sleep paralysis a few times throughout my life, but I had it maybe, I don't know, probably like 4 or 5 months ago, give or take, probably longer than that. But what actually happened was really interesting. And it has to do with the grays. And I was actually watching the movie Jupiter Ascending, which many of you are probably familiar with. It's one of the movie by the Wachowski siblings. And in the movie, it has a lot to do with like this bigger picture of our cosmic civilization, of our cosmic universe, and other like entities and other, you know, again, galactic civilizations. And also the grays are in it. And again, you know, the grays are sort of, based on who you listen to, they're sort of like these sort of almost like hired worker aliens, and they sort of do tasks for other people and other allegiances that they have and everything. And they're kind of like, yeah, like, I mean, it's hard to explain, but anyways, within the story of Jupiter Ascending, these grays are actually in the story, and they're kind of, yeah, they're kind of like doing like tasks and everything like that, and they're kind of like infiltrating people and even manipulating their memory and things. And then what actually happened is that like I was like watching this movie, and I stopped it halfway, and then I went to sleep. And so, I mean, this actually alludes into the concept of what we talked about before of like noticing how if you're doing something in the waking state, it can sometimes come up within the dream state, where if you're like watching a movie and then you go to sleep and you'll dream of that movie. And this can actually become an interesting thing, because you could actually program your dreams. This is like something that I want to get into more, like the idea of like, watch this before going to bed and you'll have a dream about this or something like that. Like imagine it became that programmable and that predictable and that consistent. That'd be like a whole new market there. A whole new potential. But so what happened within my dream, first of all, the first thing that happened that was most interesting is that my dog, my golden retriever dog, came and slept in my room with me that day. And as I tell the story in retrospect, that to me was like super interesting, because he does not normally sleep in my room, and yet for some reason, quote unquote, some reason, he was in my room that night. And then basically what ended up happening is that as I was like going to sleep, eventually like I had an experience where human potential, if you can just mute your microphone, because for whatever reason I can't mute your microphone. Perfect, thanks. So basically what happened within the dream is that I awoke in a sleep paralysis state, and in my sleep paralysis state, sort of what I observed was like an entity like standing near the end of my bed that looked like a gray, but again, it's hard for me to even say if it was a gray or if it was just like me seeing reflections off of things in my room and my imagination interpreting it as a figure that in the moment I'm just like, hey, that kind of looks as like a gray, or kind of looks like, again, it didn't even just look like a gray, it just looked like something. And there was a presence, and it felt like something, and it felt like there was something at the end of my bed, and it was like looking back at me. And what, and then within this moment, like, I had enough time to observe it, and I was freaked out, but I wasn't, like, 100% freaked out, and I was just kind of like, okay, like, I'm having sleep paralysis, like, okay, like, theoretically, there's, like, a gray at the end of my bed or something like that, and then because I was, like, you know, a little bit scared, what I actually did within my sleep paralysis state, I was able to make a little bit of noise, and this is, like, something that we've actually noticed before. Sometimes that happens in sleep paralysis where, like, some people, like, try and scream and they can't scream, sort of thing, and that could, again, this can be, like, really scary, but again, you know, we're talking about it so we can help sort of dispel some of the fear. And what I did is I like got my dog's attention. So, like, within my sleep paralysis state, I was, like, calling to my dog. Like, my dog's name is Dallin, and I was just, like, trying to make a noise, right? And I was just like, Dallin, Dallin, right? And, you know, like, and, like, barely any noise was, like, coming out, but I was, like, still trying to, like, make a noise. And then eventually, like, it was enough that, like, it, like, woke him up. And even though I wasn't very loud, I was, like, psychically trying to communicate with him. And then he came up over to me, and he, like, nudged me with his nose and just kind of burrowed his face into me and stuff like that. And then it, like, physically woke me up. And then, like, in that moment, I was just, like, I was just, like, really just, like, whoa, like, what the hell was that? Like, that's not something that happened normally for me. And I was just, like, really thankful for him being there. And so, again, you know, it was really interesting how, like, the fact that he was there, to me, alludes to this idea that animals are almost, like, connected into, like, this higher conscious intelligence and this higher intuitive intelligence. You know, like, my dog almost knew that this was going to happen, even though it may not have known that this was going to happen. You know, like, my dog was just, like, guided to be there from, like, a non-linear perspective sort of thing. And then because he was there, it allowed me to have this experience, and he was actually, like, a guardian in that scenario that allowed me to, like, be, like, able to get me out of it. And if he wasn't there, I don't know exactly what would happen. It's hard for me to say, but it was interesting. And again, you know, like, is this me, like, in retrospect, I'm like, okay, what do I get out of this experience? A, I get out of the fact that this is an experience that can happen. It's something that can happen to other people, but I'm not going to just, like, 100% jump on the bandwagon and say, like, oh, there was a gray at the end of my bed. This is what happened. Because, like I said, it was just kind of, it was also, like, the idea that I was seeing things in my room that my imagination was, like, interpolating as something similar to a gray without actually being a gray. So, I mean, I think that's something that we have to keep in mind, is that sometimes within our sleep paralysis states, sometimes, like, our imagination can feed into the moment and sort of create a character, create the projection of something that may not actually be that something, if that makes sense. So again, you know, like, can grays infiltrate dreams? Maybe-ish, you know, it's still a topic we're talking about, but regardless, sleep paralysis is still a real thing. And then you hear other people talking about, you know, like, old hags and other characters that they see, other common things that they see within sleep paralysis. But again, you know, like, ultimately, these things, as scary as they are, for me, they're also valuable teachers, because, like I said, I did my best in that moment to, like, not to sort of let go of the fear. I was just like, holy crap, this is intense, but, like, I was actually consciously, like, breathing my way through it sort of thing, instead of just being, like, completely overwhelmed. And that's why, like, when I woke up, I was actually, like, I was scared. I was still, like, kind of, like, in shock, but I was just like, wow, you know, like, that was like a psychedelic experience there. Like, that was real. Like, that was something different. And the fact that it was so otherworldly actually made me grateful to have the opportunity to experience it in that way. So yeah, that's my story. Again, you know, about, like, how my dog saved me from the grays or whatever happened. So, but if anybody has any thoughts or comments or similar stories that they want to share related to that, please feel free. You know, again, let's help dispel some of the ideas and concepts related to that. Kiwe, I think you had your mic open earlier, so we'll do Kiwe, and then Jack, if you want to jump in after that. Kiwe, go ahead.
Yeah, I just got a quick story. It isn't as good as yours. Yours was remarkable. Yeah, just when I was sleeping once, I was sleeping on my side, and I had woken up, I completely believe I had woken up, and I saw, like, I was at the side of the bed, and I saw a boy just about a foot away from me, quiet, not saying anything, just staring right at me, probably. And at first, I was not scared, though, I mean, it's a boy that I don't know that's in my room, just looking at me. And after a while, like you said, it's like I was trying to move, and then I'm trying to make any kind of sound, and no sound was coming out at all. And then that's where I got a little bit panicked, and then I eventually woke up after a while, and I think that's the... Yeah. I wasn't too scared in the fact that I just went back to sleep. I didn't stay up. I've had some dreams where I just didn't want to go back to sleep. But it was definitely a hell of an experience. And I've had a couple similar, but since that first one, I don't get as panicked. But I just think it's very, for lack of a better term, crazy that we have all these experiences where we're a sleep paralysis and we see an actual being. It just makes me think, is that with the amount of powers that aliens, and I know I'm going off the, with the amount of powers aliens possibly have, they could be in complete control of the matrix that we're living in, whatever. I'm going off the deep, but to be there if they want and have us in that state and actually be there and make us think we're just dreaming. But that's a little off. That's just my experience.
Thanks. Yeah, cool. Thanks, Kiwi. And yeah, again, you know, like there's lots of experience of people seeing weird stuff when they're half between those states. And again, you know, like there's some things that may sound stranger than fiction, but there's... this reality is very, very hyperdelic. So, I mean, nothing's too out of the realms of possibility. So, again, you know, we're investigating, we're exploring, and even exploring the darker sides, I think, is important within this investigation. So, yeah. Indigo, did you want to jump in with anything? And then if anybody else wants to, by all means, go ahead.
Yeah, I guess I can go on the topic of sleep paralysis. I've experienced a little bit, but I think I want to talk about my brother's experience that he came to me. My brother is totally asleep, meaning he is not interested in any of the spiritual stuff, and he's living totally 3D life. Doesn't, you know, anytime I bring up any spiritual stuff, it's kind of they make fun of you, they block it, which is totally cool. I love my brother no matter what. But he opened up to me one time, and he told me that there were grays visiting him and putting him under sleep paralysis, and it scared him, and he wanted, you know, my advice on what to do. He's like, oh, you talk about the spiritual stuff, like, I don't know anybody else to tell this, everybody's going to think I'm crazy and stuff, like, so I just told him, I said, man, the only advice I can give you right now is that if you're in a state of fear, it gets in control. So try to work on not being scared and try to find out what they want, you know, what they're here to connect with you about, you know. But he was kind of satisfied with that at the moment. But I went deeper, and I really connected and went to the Kosh, and I figured out what's happening, that these grays actually are going extinct, and they've made contracts with human beings in the spiritual realms that most unawakened humans aren't even aware of, that they're going to connect with their genetics to have children that are hybrids that are going to help have a continuation of their genetic line, because, as you know, humans are very filled with emotion. So I can't really tell him that, but about 6 months later, he had a child, and this child... I've met him. He's still a baby. His name's John, and he is amazing. He's definitely a hybrid. He's got super amazing, like, when you walk by him, like, your crown chakra is just blown up with all this energy that definitely is way more powerful than any human. I've been around a lot of awakened high-level human beings and lots of spiritual conferences, and this little joker is, like, powerful. So, yeah, that's what I gotta say on the subject of sleep paralysis.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else wants to open up? And thanks, Indigo. Caitlin, Sky, go ahead.
Yeah, on the subject of sleep paralysis, I've never experienced it while awake. Like, I've never been, my body's, my mind's never been, like, actually awake, but I've experienced it, like, in dreams. Like, I was dreaming of laying in bed asleep almost. One time, which was kind of had, it wasn't a gray, but it was some, it wasn't a part of me. I know that much because it really scared me a lot. And I was actually at her house that night. And I had this dream, I guess, and I was standing in the corner of her room, and there was, like, a being. And in my mind's eye, it was, like, a whitish, almost, like, cloudy white color, but it was really scary. And it kind of moved in, like, a semicircle around the room towards me. And somebody mentioned before how, like, you actually, I'm sorry, I'm terrible with names. Anyways, yeah, somebody mentioned before how, like, they were trying to scream and couldn't. And that was what I experienced with that. Like, and it happens, like, a lot in my dreams when I'm really scared. Like, I just cannot make any noise, and I'm, like, really trying, and it's just not working, and it's, like, really unexplainable. But, yeah, and it can be really scary, and it's easy to let the fear kind of overcome you. But
it's easy to overcome the fear if you can put yourself in a state of observation. Mm-hmm. That, for me, soothes so many things. Like, if you can just, like, kind of quiet the chatter going on up here as to, like, you know, trying to make sense and rationalize what it is and how to understand it, you just kind of notice it and just separate yourself from it almost, but still recognize it as an existing thing that doesn't have an intent to harm you.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, the idea of being able to become the observer of your dreams, and again, you know, like the observer within your waking state as well. Again, you know, as bringing more mindfulness, like observing your thoughts, observing the process, observing the dream, kind of doing it from this like third person perspective, can allow you to just sort of be able to like step back and not be so encased or in, you know, just like overwhelmed by whatever you like feel yourself as the, you know, whatever your emotions may be experiencing in that. So yeah, that's some good points there. Yeah, again, you know, like the sleep paralysis thing, I think it's a teacher. You know, everything's a sifu, as Paul Boggy would say. It's definitely something that we can learn, and as scary as it is, it's definitely something that we can, we can overcome that. We can gain more confidence. We can gain more understanding out of that. And again, you know, like I know other people who talk about like seeing sort of like shadow beings and stuff when they fall asleep and everything. And actually, like a friend of mine talks about like how they have to sleep with the TV on. And this is interesting because what I feel is like another thing that we need to bring up into the conversation is like the importance of sort of turning your sleeping space into a sacred space as well. Because I mean, you know, if there are like the ideas of like shadow beings and entities, and not to say like they're good or bad, but if they're sort of scaring you and they're freaking you out sort of thing, and maybe like one way how you can sort of like help with that is by just like bringing intention into your space, you know, like doing smudging, maybe putting around some crystals with a specific intention to it, maybe just cleaning up your room, bringing different colors into it, or like small night lights or something like that. But I think that's a conversation in itself, right? Like just being aware of how changing your sleeping space can affect the aspects of how you dream, and then potentially even like dreaming with another person can allow you to sort of create like a bubble of like safe space with that person. Whereas, you know, previously they might sort of feel like overwhelmed by the scenario, but if they have someone else there, this is something that I was actually experiencing, that other person can almost be sort of like a shamanic sort of like create like a shamanic space within like where it is that the two people are sleeping sort of thing. If that makes sense, they can sort of like I was thinking about this, like the idea of like, you know, almost like combating like negative entities within your mind as you're kind of like falling asleep to be able to create a safe space for the person who you're next to sort of thing. It sounds kind of like a crazy idea, and I'm not explaining it the best, and perhaps it'll be something we'll get more into another time, but it's just an idea. And again, so if anybody has anything that they want to talk about, maybe related to like noticing differences of how you dream when you're in different spaces and how that affects you, or any experience based on that, feel free to jump on that. And just jumping ahead, we'll aim to wrap up the show again within the next half hour. So we'll get into a couple more points, and then we'll get into our closing meditation with the dream tree that I'll explain once we get there. But Jack, go ahead.
Okay. I had an ex-girlfriend that I was with, and I learned that I was a dream walker because every time that we would sleep in the same bed together, I'd be able to walk right into her dreams and, like, see what's going on and be like, her dreams were, like, you know, totally different than mine. So I was like, this is, you know what I'm saying? I don't judge nobody or nothing, but it was some chaotic, crazy going stuff going on. And so, I don't know, like, your space of the aura that you're around, like, this is, I think I brought this up in another dream class, where some people are sleeping in the cities or in duplexes where their bed is next to a wall, and the wall is right next, like, behind the wall, there's another person sleeping in their bed, and your auras are mixing. And sometimes people can be, you know, getting different stuff from other people while they're sleeping because their auras are so close to each other, and they don't even, you know, they think there's a wall there, so in your mind, you think, there's a wall, nobody. But if your wall is right next to another person's bed that's in another house, that's a totally another person you don't even know, you know what I'm saying? It can have an effect somewhat on your dream. And as far as going into creating a sacred space, I have all kinds of different crystals that I put right by my bed, right by the headboard there, and I do all kinds of different grids. And sometimes I even put some under my pillow if I have certain chakras. My throat lately has been a little crazy, so I'll put throat chakra crystals there. And if I can jump back into another subject that you guys talked about before, I was trying to join earlier, but I was watching a live broadcast on YouTube, and you guys were saying, what do you guys do whenever you're trying to see if you're actually dreaming? Like, I think Brendon said the colored shoes or something, or you had a friend with colored shoes, other people were saying. For me, I just fly. I just float in the air. Like, I can't do that in physical reality. But in dream time, I can fly around. So if I ever want to check if I'm dreaming or not, I just say, can I float in the air right now? If I can, it's a pretty solid thing. So I guess I'll kind of wrap up what I'm saying and shoot it on to somebody else.
Yeah, just hitting on the flying thing. Again, yeah, like, that is a reality check, and it's we've mentioned it before in previous broadcasts, but you can do that for people throughout the day. You know, check if you can fly within the waking state. But again, when you're checking, the subtle variation I sort of bring in is, like, the difference between just, like, trying to jump with the intention of, like, seeing whether or not you fall down, or you jump with the intention of flying. So it's sort of like check in with your heart. So don't just jump to see whether gravity will pull you down. Jump with the intention of floating up. And so it's this process of, like, letting go. And that's, again, you know, within dreams I've experienced that, where I'm just like, can I float right now? And then I might, like, start floating for, like, half a second. But then I come back down because, like, in my mind, I'm just like, gravity, still exists, So it's about, like, letting go of, like, those physical density concepts that bleed over into our matrix of the dream space that sort of determine, like, so part of the characteristics of it. But yeah, like, floating, checking if you can float within this reality, you know, maybe every time every hour or something, just try jumping, and then again, you can sort of repeat that within a dream space. And yeah, I want to talk more about jumping and flying around and stuff. I will say, guys, we're going to have to get close to wrapping this up soon, and part of the reason is just because I got to go take care of my dog downstairs. He's barking, and I just don't want to keep the rest of the household up, but we'll move into some final notes and then short micro meditation related to the common space of the dream tree. I'll just say real quick, within this broadcast, within the previous dream classes, we've been doing this idea of meeting up within a shared space, within the dream space. And one of the things that we do for that is meeting up at the dream tree. And this is, I'll post a link in the chat for you guys to see that. But it's the promotional image that you see for the broadcast. And it's like, again, you know, this person sort of standing on the checkerboards of knowledge, you know, between the two pillars of knowledge, and they're looking out onto a field and they see a tree. More so, less about the checker fields and the checkerboards and the and the pillars, but more focusing on the concept of the tree out in the field with the paradigm shift sigil floating above it. This is like a space that we're creating within the dream to be able to like gather around as a concept. It's being like a beacon or a portal for us to think about as we fall asleep and for us to meet up at within the astral space in the same way we can meet up within this physical space. And we actually did have one of our friends, Ashley, who has talked about how she actually had a dream where she was there, and there were others of us who were like hanging around at the tree. And so it's cool to hear that other people have made it there. And again, that's for me, like that's like a personal goal, to like become lucid and then to be like, okay, I want to go to the tree, and then, you know, you teleport to the tree and you bring yourself there. So it's actually creating an objective, it's creating a tangible goal. And yeah, it's just something that is a interesting recurring theme that we can sort of bring into classes time and time again. Again, you know, like one thing that I will say is that within dreams, it does seem that there's like parts of ourselves that can be very busy within the dream space that we may not even hear about. Every now and then somebody will message me online and tell me about how like I showed up in one of their dreams. And what's interesting is that like sometimes they've told me stories about things that I've done in their dreams that have actually sort of like revealed to me another part of myself. And I was just like, oh, that's really cool to hear that like this happened or I played this role within your dream. And like I've had other people tell me about their dreams where within their dreams I've like played like the role of like sort of like a shamanic healer and things. And so I was like, oh, that's really interesting. Again, you know, like was that their projection of me, or was that projection again like sort of like tapping into the energetic code of my essence, sort of thing? So without me, like without my conscious reality technically needing to be there, there was still like the energy of my essence that was appearing within the dream, appearing in their dream, that was still a reflection of like who I am and who I can become, sort of thing. So I mean, there's a whole topic there just about like, you know, like, yeah, I feel when we look at things as like packages of energy, then we can start to sort of figure out how characters appear within dreams. So it's like, you know, like, am I talking to Einstein or am I talking to the energetic pattern of Einstein, sort of thing? It's kind of like a hologram of him that contains all the knowledge and the information without maybe being like the actual consciousness of Einstein, so to speak. But again, you know, words sort of have a challenging time kind of wrapping their head around that, but we'll do the best we can and we'll get into more stuff as we go. Jack, go ahead. Yep.
Brendon, I just want to congratulate you on your interview with Kirk Spiritual Television.
Oh, thanks.
I saw that, man, and I just wanted to say, dude, blessings, and you're getting out there, and we have something that we've already kind of, we're going to release that. We don't really want to say anything, but dude, you're growing, you're expanding, man. I just want to take a second to show that appreciation for you, man.
Thanks, man. Thanks. I appreciate that. And again, you know, like it's shared growth. Like that's the exciting thing, you know, like each one of us as we bring in new experiences, we're like bringing new experiences into the community. And again, you know, like that's why I really encourage people when they're bringing it, you know, when they're having these new synchronicities, when they're getting these new inspirations, when they're creating new art, when they're having new visceral dreams, if you can share those within the community, that's like really awesome, because it's bringing it into that collective experience. It's like downloading it so that we all share and learn from it. You know, like that's, I love that idea. If someone has a really epic dream and then someone else reads about it, as if like that person downloads that experience themselves. So, you know, we can collectively, we're adding our experiences together here. So yeah, no, I always say victory is a shared success. So thank you again to everyone for being a part of this project. And for those of you who just aren't entirely sure, Jack was referencing, I was doing a live television broadcast with our good friend Kirk, who does a show on Manhattan Public Access TV. And again, you can find that through my YouTube channel at Skull Babylon and through the main Paradigm Shift Central website under the Quest Journals as well. But yeah, that was like the debut for Paradigm Shift Central on live TV, and I honestly don't know how many people would tune into it, but obviously it exists online now, so it was awesome practice, and we'll do that some more. We'll experience some more ways to engage in digital shiftivism by using the mainstream media to get more conscious themes out there. So yeah, no, thanks again to Jack and to everyone for being a part of this. Okay, so yeah, like I said, we're getting close to the end of the show. Let's bring in some any final thoughts or even any like questions that you guys might just want to leave for the group to ponder on, or anything else that you guys want to share, or just like any feedback on what you thought of the broadcast tonight. Like that can be your thing, you know, just like what are your thoughts and feedback on what we did tonight, and anybody wants to jump in on that too. So before we wrap this up. Yeah, so you know it's getting to the end of the broadcast when everyone's like getting a little quiet and tired. It's just like we're like half asleep at this point. It's just like literally we'll just like fall asleep during the broadcast. That's gonna happen. So cool. Okay, well let's just literally again, like I said, pass the talking stick around for one final time. Kiwe, we'll just go around the group. So Kiwe, is there any final message that you just want to share with the people tuned in to this, or anything that you want to share? Go ahead.
Tough to say. Nothing's really popping into mind. Just I feel like, as Indigo said, just want to show my appreciation. I wanted to choose a different word than work, but it seems like the best word is work. Your work, I'm humbled by your passion. I respect it. I love it for you, and you changing minds and lives for the better. So just want to say thanks. That's all that's coming to mind right now.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you too, man. Thank you too. Kiwe and I, we've known each other for quite a few years now. We met in a thing called Toastmasters, which is like a public speaking group. And yeah, it's been really cool to like meet there and to both of us to sort of get involved with more of the paradigm shifty conversations over the years. So thank you, man, and I appreciate you as well. And cool. Okay, well let's just keep going around the circle. Like I said, if you say as much or as little as you want, I just want to give you guys a chance to just sort of practice delivering a closing message to the people listening or anything. Dustin, if you want to just, you're next on my left to right, but Dustin, is there anything you want to say to the audience or anything in general? Please feel free.
There's a lot I do want to say, but my voice is waking up like everyone in the house, so I'll just keep it short and say that this was an interesting class. Dreams are always interesting, and it's a pretty cool thing you got going on. And I just wish I could say more, because there's so much to say. So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, definitely there will be more chances. So thanks for being here, Dustin. Appreciate it. Jack, was there anything else that you want to say? Again, you know, maybe just closing thoughts for people tuning into this, words of inspiration, insight to go out on.
The dream time is the fourth dimension. The fourth dimension is the reality construct that's above the third dimension. It's the mental reality that drops down into the third dimension. If you have a problem, let's say, with a bully on the playground, you're going to fight that bully in your dreams many times, many, many times, until you beat that bully. And then once you beat that bully, you have the confidence in physical reality to not have any fear of him. And once you have no more fear of that bully, the bully won't bother you. So your dreams are here to help you grow into the best version of yourself. So the parting note is, let your dreams turn you into the best version of you.
Oh, I dig it, man. I dig it. Cool. And thanks again, Indigo, for rocking it and for being here and adding your voice. I appreciate it, man. Much more to come. John, is there anything else you want to share? Please feel free.
I'm the same with Dusty. I'm like waking up everybody. so I gotta get my voice down, but what Indigo just said really resonates with me. Totally had that experience where, you know, there was a bully and I beat him in my dreams, so I was able to have the confidence to not be afraid of him in real life, and it manifested peace. Didn't even end up fighting him. But one thing, if I can say to those listening, is that learn to dream while awake. And in doing so, that means learn to meditate, learn to journey. Because you'll bring those same techniques into your dream, whether they're lucid or whether they're vivid. Your dreams definitely have something to teach you. And bringing your meditations into your dreams will just, you know, amp those up to, you know, much better. It'll make it much better. So that's what I would, that's what I gotta say.
Cool. Awesome. Well, thanks again, John, a.k.a. Ron, a.k.a. Guardian of the Forest. So thanks for being here, man. Appreciate it. Yeah, there's a couple thoughts I'll share just as well, but we'll pass the talking stick. Caitlin, Sky, if you guys are still awake, is there anything you want to share with the other dreamers out there before we get close to wrapping this up? Go ahead.
I just personally wanted to say and appreciate how I feel like I've met every single one of you, in a sense. Like, every time I meet a new person, it's almost like meeting a new part of myself, and it is so humbling. But I just wanted to appreciate how incredibly eccentric and enlightened all of you are, and say that throughout this entire conversation, it has not only put perspective on a lot of things and introduced new concepts, but actually articulated and put into words things that I've understood personally, and it's crazy when you think about how much you can learn about a person and how much of a life we live in our dreams and through our dreams, you know. And I just really wanted to appreciate just everything that this whole program is, this whole chat stream is. It makes me feel so loving, and I just want to share that.
Yeah, what everybody has said is so completely just perfect, like it's on point, and everything just reflects everything else so well, and I know that's extremely vague, it's just really hard to put feelings into words sometimes, and again, appreciation, it seems like a very repetitive word, but really it just seems to match very well what I am feeling and kind of the flow of everything right now. And, I mean, with your dreams, you know, you don't have to, you know, try for anything. Like, your goals are good, yes, but regular dreams versus lucid dreams, you know, like, they can both mean, and you can grow from them both just as much, you know, the same. That's really all I have to say. Thank you for everything.
And allowing us to be part of the experience.
Cool.
I want to say thank you for that.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm happy that you guys got to make it in here tonight, and again, you know, like, this will be, you know, I hope you have the best sleepover ever, obviously, you know, just let these ideas, like, permeate into your dream, and I mean, that's the thing, like, all of us, you know, we're just, like, we're talking about dreams, then we're just gonna, like, go, like, right into the dream space, and each one of us is gonna be, like, blasting off into a multi-dimensional dimension, and I think that's really exciting, so that for me is really why I feel this space is important, knowing that what we're doing right now is still only just the beginning. And what happens when we begin to learn how to articulate this language, and we begin to explain these spaces, and we begin to create more conversation, and not only that, but invite more people to be a part of the conversation. I think it's really important, and having that community when it comes to dreams is really powerful, because it just reminds and encourages us that this is something that it takes focus and it takes attention. And sometimes, you know, people will be interested in dreams and then they won't be interested in dreams, but they can always come back to being interested in dreams. So through the collective support of community, it's really powerful. Again, going back to what Indigo was saying and just what everyone was saying, that the real goal in this is to be able to, like, awaken to our best self, awaken to our higher elf, awaken into more of what we are capable of as multidimensional beings. And yeah, like that, again, you know, the term dreaming, I mentioned this in a previous broadcast, to me, and we can sort of get close to wrapping this up here, the term dreaming to me means the like the process of thoughts creating reality. So I mean, that in itself just relates back to this idea that we are always dreaming. It's just a matter of not we're awake. So we're always going to be dreaming. So, I mean, our thoughts are always creating reality. It's waking up to that dream. It's waking up to that process. So that, for me, is, like, the big kicker, right? Like, our dreams are teaching us how to become, like, better manifestors and how reality works so that we can understand how it works in this dimension, too, understanding that the two are very much one and the same. So yeah, much appreciation and thank you to everyone for being here. And yeah, like I said, I just want to end this off with a super short meditation just related to the dream tree so we can put some more energy towards that. Just before we go into that, I just want to cover some basis and just let you guys know that, again, the next broadcast that we'll be doing will be coming up on Thursday on June 16th. That's a paradigm shift admin meeting. And again, you know, the bigger project here is about creating the physical paradigm shift community. So much of what we did here in the digital space can be replicated in a physical community. It can be replicated in a circle where you bring people together and you talk about dreams some more. And everybody listening to this has the potential to create a paradigm shift community where they are. And if that's something that interests you, if you want to help build the tribe, evoke synchronicity, bring people together, create new bonds, and have new friends for a lifetime, then be sure to tune into the admin meeting and even go back and listen to the previous one. And again, that's going to be at 9 p.m. on Thursday, June 16th. And then after that, we're going to have a full moon guided journey meditation, and that's going to be again, you know, like a waking guided dream, and that's a really exciting thing. And we'll be going back into the elf zone for that, and that's going to be on the full moon of June 20th, the day before the solstice on June 21st. And so that would be a lot of potent energy there, so I definitely invite and encourage you guys to sync up with that either live or listen to it in the future. As always, all of these broadcasts are recorded online. And of course, just reminding you guys that a huge part of what makes this project possible is our ongoing team crowdfunding that allows the consistent support and production time required to create these broadcasts and to make them possible and to bring more free consciousness shifting media to the community. That's a big part with Paradigm Shift that I've always had from the beginning, is that, you know, I want everything to be free. I want everything to be accessible. So through the people signing up through the team Patreon, that allows things to continue to be free, and there's a lot more that is supporting. And you can check that out at patreon.com/Brendon Culliton, or even just on the main part of the website. If you just scroll down to the bottom, you'll see a link for the monthly support squad, or go to paradigmsessential.com/donate, or just send me a message on Facebook if that works for you. And you can sign up for $3 a month, and you can get as many shift buttons as you asked for. And again, that's one of the buttons that I'm wearing here, and those are part of the real world game to help shift consciousness, and we use those to hack the matrix, connect with community, and to build the tribe where we are. So thank you again to everybody signed up for that. Currently, we're at about 471, and our goal is to get over 500 and up to 600 potentially by the end of June. That was an objective, that was a dream objective that I put out there. And yeah, if anybody is able to sign up for that when they can, please feel free. And that's a huge commitment. And again, you know, just supporting more ongoing great things for the community. It's helping us help everyone. So thank you again to everyone for helping in every way. So much love. Okay, guys, let's get ready to go into just a short closing meditation, like honestly really short, but I encourage you to expand this concept within your mind and to continue this as a meditation within your own practice. So if you remember from previous broadcasts, or if you have the image in front of you, all the promo images that we're using right now are that tree out in the field. So it's a tree out in the field, and then there's the paradigm shift sigil, which again is like this magic beacon, and it's kind of floating above it. And the idea is that this tree in a field, as simple as it is a space that we are creating through our shared focus, through our shared imagination, nation of the magi, I am Jin, to be able to create it in the dream space, to be able to crystallize it in the dream space. So, I mean, you know, this is an experiment, so to speak, but it is something that, based on all the information we have, is possible. And like I said, one of our friends, Ashley, has actually gotten there, or at least her interpreted version of it, and I encourage more of us to do that. So we'll do a small meditation here, but then I encourage you to think about this concept as you fall asleep, or at least think about it during the day, or anytime you see the paradigm shift sigil, you can think about that as like something to meditate on that can bring you to this shared space. And then we can have shared meetups within the astral place. So again, you know, just thinking about it as like a advanced form of digital technology. How do we utilize it? How do we access it? How do we access that console command and load up MP underscore tree in a field, so to speak. So let's I invite you guys to just like get nice and relaxed and close your eyes. And again, we're just going to do a short micro meditation. So just relax your shoulders, straighten up your spine, and just connect with your breath right here in this moment. So gentle inhales through the nose and gentle exhales through the mouth or the nose. And just continuing to breathe and even noticing how even just less than 30 seconds into simply closing your eyes and breathing, already the space that it brings you into, the difference within your attention, within your awareness. So just take a couple more breaths. Exhales, relax. As you allow your breath to continue to flow, begin to imagine the concept of the tree in the middle of a field. You can almost imagine yourself floating around it from a disembodied perspective, like a camera floating around it, and just see what type of tree it is to you. It can either be a simple tree, or it can be as magical as you choose to make it look. And continuing to breathe, just begin to paint this picture in your mind and begin to see an aura around the tree, an energy to it, recognizing this tree as a symbol, as a beacon of home, a beacon of family, a beacon of our roots, of our connection, as above, so below, understanding that we are the tree. As much as it is outside of us, it is also a reflection of what's in us. And so as you continue to float around the tree, acknowledge and add in with your imagination the paradigm shift sigil, which again, off the top of your mind, if you're not entirely familiar with it, you can think of it like a compass, like a four-pointed star floating above the tree. And taking a moment to breathe into this, even activating any activation sensations, knowing that this sigil carries with it a potent, a loving, and an encoded energy that connects all of us, that is in itself a gate that we are continuing to enrich in, that we are continuing to activate. So this sigil, this beacon, this compass, this star floats above the tree. And just imagine this in your mind, in your mind's eye, in your imagination, adding texture to it. The more you think about it, it's like adding more paint to the canvas, more pixels to the picture, more details to the realm. And so by all of us taking the moment simply to think of this concept, it begins to manifest it within the spiritual realms, within the astral realms. It begins to crystallize it through our shared intent as a place that we can go, that we can see, that we can engage with. So you see this tree, magical in this field, pulsating with a soft aura, and the sigil, a beacon, floating above it, connecting its energy into the tree as well. And just take a moment here to begin to float your awareness down to the base of the tree. And if you want, you can imagine a physical body that you're a part of. And just take a moment here to extend your hand out in front of you and connect your open palm to the tree. And in this moment, feeling the texture of the trunk on your hand or your hands, feeling it, acknowledging its life, feeling the heartbeat of the tree as the heartbeat of yourself. So just take a breath here. Take another breath and listen to your heartbeat this time as the tree's heartbeat. And so I invite you in your imagination before we leave to even just give the tree a hug. Trees love hugs. And tell the tree how much you appreciate it as you do all of the trees, telling that one tree is talking to all the trees, is talking to Mother Gaia herself, to all the branches that connect each and every one of us, all of our stories, together. So just take another moment here to hug the tree in your imagination, connect with it, and listen to your heartbeat as the heartbeat of the tree. And so taking your time, still imagining if you want, hugging it, you can slowly release. And before we leave here, just taking a moment to look up at the tree underneath, see more of its texture, more of its branches, acknowledge the richness and the realness of this space, encoding it with your focus, with your attention, painting it with your mind. And even in this space, just looking off around the tree, you notice other little floating orbs of light, acknowledging that each one of those is another spirit, another soul, another shifter journeying to this tree, acknowledging this tree as a meeting point, as a place for council, a place for community, a place for the round table, and a place for magic. And so you see these other orbs floating around the tree, each one of them us. Each one of them unique, and knowing that you yourself are one of those orbs as well. And so in this moment, I encourage you to even just stay near the tree. You can imagine yourself even just sitting down, casually observing it, but slowly we'll begin to bring our awareness back out of this meditation. But again, just before you do, acknowledge the details of the space. And know that within your own meditation, as you go to sleep at night, even during the day, just imagine yourself slowly walking up to this tree. Imagine yourself taking the time to touch it, to hug it, just as we did, to show it your appreciation and your gratitude. Tell the universe it's your intention to go there in the dream space, and it will be true, because it already is. And so just taking these moments, seeing the tree, seeing the texture, bringing in awareness to all your sensations, feeling the ground underneath your feet, feeling the presence and the love of the space in your heart. And keeping yourself there within your imagination, slowly, we'll begin to bring our awareness back to our physical body. And so, slowly allowing ourselves to be still at the tree in our imagination as we bring ourselves back to the awareness of our physical bodies with a couple more breaths. So taking your time, gentle inhales, exhales, gratitude in the heart. Openness to the journey still ahead, ever expanding, ever unfolding, inwards and outwards. And with another breath, you can bring your awareness back to your physical body by wiggling your fingers and your toes, and become aware of the chair or the ground underneath you. And when you're ready, you can gently open your eyes and return your awareness to the space around you. So even with your eyes open, just sort of check back in. Can you still remember what that space was? Can you still see it? How real is it? It's simple. It's a simple concept, but that's what makes it effective. A tree in a field, that's it, you know, with the sigil above it. It's the energy to it that is something that you remember, that your soul recognizes. So again, you know, I invite people to set that intention, to write it in their dream journals before they go to bed, you know, like meet at the tree, meet at the dream tree. We can call it the dream tree. And there's more to that story that is yet to be told as well. And I'm excited to be able to tell it with you guys. And so we'll get there as we get there. And yeah, Jack, go ahead. You open your microphone if you have something to share. Go ahead.
You know, everybody has different perceptions of their visions that they see in their meditation, but I saw what was like that movie where those children were running through that field and they were like the chosen children and the parents. I don't know the movie, but there was like waving grass all around, like, man, it was beautiful, and I saw the sigil up top, and like that tree, it's you. It's like a part of you, and it's gonna stay here even after you're gone. Like it's what you're building, and I just had to add that. So don't, you know? Whew. Thank you for sharing that with me.
Whew. Thank you too, man. Thank you for creating it with us. So. If anybody else wants to share anything related to that, again, you know, I think it's cool for you guys to share your dream visions, your meditation dream visions. Because again, you know, like what are guided meditations? They're like guided waking dreams, essentially. John, did you want to share anything? I know you gotta keep your volume low, but if not, that's totally fine. Yeah. Okay. So John says he saw a root sticking out of the bottom. Interesting, the little details. So yeah, and again, you know, like add in your own textures to this vision. You know, like the grass can be what you want it to be, the sky can be what you want it to be, the tree can be what you want it to be. It's the concept, really. So does anybody else? Caitlin, Sky, go ahead.
I personally witnessed just how deep and layered the tree was. You know, it was almost like it was saturated with more than just life force energy. Like there was so many different densities and coatings of it and so many different layers of it, and to me it's so symbolic to the reality we live every day. You know, like it's not just the physical world and the five sensory world, it's the etheric realm, it's the fourth dimension bleeding into the third dimension. It's a perfect representation of life, and to me I just feel really grateful to have been a part of a collective meditation, because the entire time I was completely conscious that while we may not have been seeing the same tree, or maybe it didn't have the same thickness or shape or density, it is still, as you said, a created space that we can all share, and it is still felt by every single one of us. And to me, it is so beautiful to think about, you know, the unity of it, how we are connecting with human beings, like, in different locations, but you know, I am you from another observation point, and I don't know, I just wanted to share that.
Oh, that's awesome. Caitlin, you look like you're falling asleep. Do you want to say anything or just nod along? That's totally cool. Thumbs up.
Well, I'm not really like falling asleep. I'm just kind of observing, okay. And appreciating everything that's going on around me. I tend to just observe more than I input.
Cool. Well, definitely, I appreciate you guys taking the time to be here. And again, you know, for everyone, for adding your energies to it, that's the exciting thing about what makes this unique. You know, we're a community is a mandala. You know, I really like that visual image, and each one of us is like the aspects and the details of the mandala as we work our way in towards the center. And at the center, it's like all of us sort of thing. So that tree is the center of the mandala. And, you know, like, look at the tree from above, and you see that. And yeah, like, that for me, you know, within the paradigm shifts is just, like, for anybody who hasn't yet, go ask a tree what you can learn from it. Go sit in front of a tree and ask yourself what you can learn from it. So, yeah. And Jack was talking about the movie Knowing, with the kids, like, running in the field and stuff like that. Yeah, I think I know what you're talking about. That's, like, with Nicolas Cage and stuff like that. Yeah, I'll have to go back and watch that scene, because I know what you're talking about. Yeah, there's, like, they're, like, floating in orbs or something like that. It's very dreamlike. But you're right, there's a tree in there. I'll have to go back and watch that. Cool. All right. Well, with that said, does anybody else have anything that they else wanted to share related to the tree aspect and the meditation aspects? If not, that's totally fine, because we're about to wrap this up. So, looks like we're good. Cool, guys. Okay, so again, you know, with that said, thank you so much for everyone for being a part of this. Oh, yeah, The Fountain, that's another good movie, with also has the Tree of Life in it as well. So, yeah, definitely... So definitely, thank you so much, guys, for being a part of this, for being a part of this broadcast. And again, you know, just I hope this, not hope, I am happy that this broadcast will allow, you know, will bring more to your journey, will allow you to strengthen your resolve, will give you that little bit of inspiration, knowing that there are other dreamers out there. And that's the exciting thing, when all of us collectively start documenting the waking life and the dream life, and those experiences collectively become richer, and we're going to start having more shared dream experiences. And like I said, we're still just at the beginning, and there's still so much more still to come. So to all the dreamers out there, aloha, I see you, I thank you, and I love you so much. So cool. All right, guys. Well, with that said, let me just take one more second here to make sure that everything is being mentioned. And yeah, again, you know, just inviting people, if they haven't yet, check out the Main Paradigm Shift Central website. Be sure to sign up, create your profile, be a part of the real world game. Again, inviting people to sign up for the Team Patreon when they can. That's a huge part that keeps this project going. And you can find my personal links at youtube.com/skullbabylon and facebook.com/skullbabylon. And if you haven't yet, go check out the Journey to Lucidity movies. Those are other full length movies that we have online through the community. You can find them through the main website under Shift Movies or on my YouTube channel, and they also have themes of lucid dreaming. So reminding you guys, you're always going to be dreaming. It's just a matter of whether or not you're awake. So for everyone here, let's join me, and if you can, unmute yourself, in saying farewell to the people of the internet, and we'll officially wrap up this broadcast. So thank you so much, dreamers, all you beautiful people out there. Until next time, so say goodbye, everyone. Say goodbye.
Good night.
Good night. Live lucid, guys.
Good night. Have a wonderful evening.
All right, guys, thank you so much. And again, for everybody who's in this broadcast, you can find links to their profiles in the show notes. And until next time, I'll see you guys in the future, and keep it shifty. One love. Peace.